evening. Welcome to the Planning Commission meeting. It's our October 24th meeting. We'll start the meeting with the Pledge of Allegiance.
Pledge of Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Next on the agenda, we have approval of the September 26, 2016 meeting minutes. I confess, I did not look at them, and I hope somebody did.
I did. I thought they were fairly comprehensive.
Okay.
I'll move to accept them.
I'll second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
And opposed. Okay, next on the agenda, we have citizens' comments, and these are for items that are not on the agenda. If we have anyone who'd like to come up and just give your name and address, and go for it. Well, that was fun. Okay, so next on the agenda, let's let Andrea settle down, okay, and we'll let Tim Goodfellow come up. Yay, Tim!
Good morning, Planning Commission members. I have two things just to give you some updates on. One is the update of the Monocacy Scenic River Management Plan. I might have mentioned that in the past. The Monocacy is one of nine state designated scenic rivers. Each of them has an advisory body and a management plan. So the river board is made up of five people from Carroll and five people from Frederick, and they've released a revised, updated management plan. It's out for public comment now until November 9th. We're having two public open houses, informational meetings, the 7th of November in Tawnytown and the 9th of November in Frederick, just to get additional public comment. But it's on the website. There's a press release and a newspaper notice, so that's one of the things we're working on now. Then the other one I want to update you on is the Little Frederick, the county's comprehensive plan update. The county's has been spending a lot of time on creating these vision statements. There was a survey that went out, it was an online survey, asking a series of questions for people to answer. We got over 1,500 responses. We've grouped all those into the different categories based on the chapters in the draft plan. And the chapters, I'll just give you a rundown of those. Agricultural economy and land preservation, economic futures and education, energy and environment, healthy communities and public services, heritage and historic preservation, housing opportunities and affordability, and finally, transportation and public infrastructure. So the county is hard at work now trying to create a draft plan, nowhere near public release or public comment at this point, but it's like a vision plan. These chapters I mentioned, that's going to kind of follow underneath like the broad overriding vision that's being created right now based on all the responses from the survey. And then each chapter is going to have their own kind of vision statement, again, kind of modeled after all the responses we've gotten from the surveys. And then, there'll be lots of like trends and drivers and metrics related to all those topics that I mentioned. And then basically a whole series of initiatives and sub-initiatives or supporting initiatives, which are like policy recommendations, action items, and things like that. I remember the Planning Commission asking if there would be any kind of formal public outreach or communication with the towns. And I don't have an answer to that right now. I need to find the answer to that easy question, but I don't have an answer to that right now. Once this plan is kind of the initial draft is done in late December, it'll go through our Planning Commission and then to the council. So, probably early next year there'll be something to kind of process and digest and comment on. But I will follow up on the outreach and communication with the towns from the people that are managing this project.
Thank you. Anyone have any questions for Tim? Comments?
At MPCA, this Thursday and Friday, there's a panel of, I'm assuming it's representation from most of the counties in Frederick County, and they're talking about planning initiatives. the county. So, I mean, what better opportunity than...
There's not a planning commissioner's workshop yet. Some people are planning commissioner attending.
Great. Thanks, Tim.
Okay, sure.
Thanks for coming. Appreciate it. Okay, Andrea, you ready?
Just a couple of things to update you on. There is a part of the Civil War Heritage Area, which Carroll County, Frederick County, Washington County are all members of. We do have mini grants throughout the, actually just once a year, but there's our four grants of $2,500. So if match it, you do a match, and then it's for a private bill more than $5,000. To my understanding, I have not seen the application yet. There's an application that's going to come through for all of the official main streets in Carroll, which I'm sure most probably knows about, but Mount Airy being one of them. So I did offer the extra review, the extra layer review by me, and Sandy Anderson from Westminster is kind of heading this, I believe. So I offered to her, she wanted me to take an extra look on it because I'm one of the grant people, so I can offer some assistance if she wants me to. I don't have much more information about, but I just wanted to just give you a heads up that that's coming down the pipe soon. Water and sewer, as I talk about what seems like every month, we took the amendment cycle, so the spring, that included Brittany Manor and kind of the redo of Mount Airy's water and sewer section. We took that to the Board of Commissioners for a public hearing this month, between our two meetings. Also did discussion and deliberations with them, and they forwarded to Maryland Department of the Environment, and I just did that on Wednesday of last week. So we'll get a letter in the mail probably in just a week or two saying that they got it, and that we're actually starting our official review. But I wanted to let you know it has been submitted on your behalf and on behalf of everyone else who had an amendment in that package. Earlier this month was State Highway Administration's pre-tour. I was not there, but I know Heather was able to attend the pre-tour. The regular tour, which is for elected officials, is scheduled for sometime. It was just rescheduled for elected officials sometime in early November, and staff should have all that information as well. I needed to check in with you all and see if you still wanted someone transportation related to come to your November 21st meeting. I found out that Bobby Moser, who I told you last meeting, she's more doing some other projects at this time, so the highway needs inventory letter and the transportation, our priority letter, is actually done by my supervisor, Linda Eisenberg. So if you wanted someone to attend the meeting, she would probably be the better person in our office to join us. So I just wanted to throw that out there, if that's something that you all still wanted. And if so, I can try and get on her calendar as well.
Heather, what's the agenda like for the November 21st? The agenda is packed.
It is a fairly heavy agenda. Mm-hmm. We have some projects that we want to get before you for approval so that the developers can move forward. I'll know better the time constraints for those discussions.
Can you work with Andrea then?
Well, in November, it was actually just suggested by this body. We have no, whatever works better for your schedule, if it's in December or January, or something along those lines. But
we don't typically do a December meeting because it's right after the holidays. And so we would look at, if we can't get it in November, then and weather's not bad in January?
Yeah, I mean, and it's totally, like I said, it was up to you, or if there are specific questions that, you know, this body has, and if you want to email the questions, maybe Linda can sit down and, you know, formulate all these responses.
Yeah. No, I thought you were the one who had questions.
Well, I think part of the larger context that we're interested in, now that we have an updated master plan, and we're close to finalizing, two new zoning districts. We've already sent one to council, MXD. Hopefully we're close. And that's really destined for our infill areas. Some of the larger context for us then is the county's plans, the county's direction in terms of traffic management. It is one example because of the proximity of 27 and 70 and so forth. and we are a gateway for the county. So what you see in that regard, and what you see with 32 and the other major arteries, and the same is true especially for water and sewer. What do you see as our capacity in the county? How do you see that distributed around the county? That's critically important in terms of the strategic planning for the county. And because we have such a distributed arrangement of communities, all fairly small, okay, what's the larger context of those issues, those critical planning issues?
Do you want to get those questions in an email, Bill?
Sure. But, I mean, the big ones, I think, would be useful to us in terms of the county context for what we're trying to do and understand how Mount Airy fits into that with our planning.
Yeah. Well, Andrea, speak, and then Mike has a comment.
Mike, you can have a comment first.
Okay, Mike, you have to come up here, though. Come on, your little exercise program.
O'Brien on Park Avenue. I think her value to us, I think, is one of the biggest things right now is how she can help us extract the most we can out of this corridor stuff. Mm-hmm. And mm-hmm. what contributions she would suggest or whatever. And if that can be facilitated, I think that would be a great help.
That's true.
Thank you. Carroll County is, and Frederick County politely declined any further engagement since Maryland 27 didn't necessarily affect them too much. But Carroll County is a key identified stakeholder. And as we finalize that first draft, there will be a stakeholder meeting to present to stakeholders such as Carroll County Government, the State Highway Administration, so our county transportation partners. So we will follow up on that, and I'm sure Andrea will be included in those meetings along with her superiors.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. And before Andrea sits down, I wanted to thank you very much, in addition to the county, for all of your effort with the Water and Sewer Master mm-hmm. Plan amendments. It completely benefits the town, and we provide you with the information, but you do all of the back and forth with MDE and all of the heavy carrying with your commissioners and explaining a very complex situation to the county commissioners, and you do so very eloquently and succinctly, better than I can say it. So I just wanted to take a moment to thank you for all of your efforts.
Yeah, all of us. Thank you. And I know it's hard being away from the sun, so. Okay, so the reason why we're really all here tonight, mixed-use draft, continued discussion. Let's jump right back into it because we have stuff to do. Heather, how do you want to start this?
I would firstly like to acknowledge and introduce Mr. Chuck Boyd from the Maryland Department of Planning. We are very lucky to have Chuck here this evening. Chuck is he serves as the Frederick County liaison to the town, but he's basically a dynamo in the Maryland Department of Planning. So he wears many hats. So I wanted to introduce him and thank you very much.
Absolutely.
For coming to help facilitate his experience with mixed-use developments. So,
thank you for coming.
And there are a lot of familiar faces in the audience. We have the Kaz brothers here this evening. We have some members of the Beck family. We have Mr. Bill McCullough representing the Economic Development Commission, and thank you very much for your comments. We have Mr. Dave Bowerstock here, and Dave and I have been talking the past couple years on the progress of the MXD. And of course, we have our partners with Kaz Brothers, I believe.
Oh, thanks for bringing that.
Okay. Yeah. And Mr. Thompson. So and a lot of other familiar faces. I don't know if they'll be participating in the discussion or not. So I see this as an informal work session opportunity. In your packages, we have provided to you comments, and I forgot my most important person, Melissa Thorne. She's our economic development manager, and she has provided comments as well. So those comments have been provided to you for consideration. Among those comments are from Victor and Craig. I'm going to say from the Kaz brothers, because I am terrified I'm going to mess up your last name, but it's respectful. So I would, did we just want to go from where we hit the first comment?
Yep.
And no need to discuss anything that isn't a concern, probably?
Mm-hmm. So Heather, where are we
starting?
Where are we starting, Heather?
Yeah. Well, let's start with the Mr. McCullough's comments. I think we should look at them consecutive, like all have all three comments
yeah,
in right. front of us.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
But I believe that probably.
Is this so we're starting on the first page.
Yes.
Because we do have comments. Okay.
So let's take Mr. McCullough's comments. And Bill, did you want to
Okay.
So is that this one that says comments concerning?
It's the one, I'm sorry, yes. I know
okay.
it's from Bill.
Okay.
All right.
This one's the one from Bill.
It's the one that starts off that says the Economic Development Commission.
Yeah, that's the one I assumed it was. I just had to make sure.
So on if the the third comment suggests that a slight verbiage change.
Just in the town of Nutley. But you're talking about number 3.
Yeah. 3A.
Yeah, 3A.
Okay. Oh, the other one.
The other one's
yeah, the others
are not really
supporting
yeah.
comments.
Yeah. Thank you for that, by the way. I like that.
Yes.
Okay.
Well, I mean, the reason that we had the language number 3 is because there was a target area for the first phase, and that's why that was the reason it did not include the entire town. Are we still,
I would ask your fellow commission members.
Yes.
I mean, we have identified properties within a certain target area, but that would be up to the Planning Commission to digest that and see if they wanted to continue having that.
And I'm not sure if we've ever discussed that outside of a work group. Bill, you were in the group. Roxanne was as well.
I don't think we have either, but I feel like it's a big project, and from the get-go, we felt like MXD.
Your microphone. Sorry.
We felt like MXD made sense because of the flexibility and the comprehensiveness of it. But we also felt that each of these areas might have a different application. And the flexibility was valuable because you are trying to complement different situations in every case. Where we start in terms of infill, it may turn out to be a different application or a different set of needs or things we're working with. Then after those spaces are worked on and we're looking at others that might even potentially be outside the current town boundary. So
I like the within the town boundary. I think the
one that he has here?
Yeah.
Yeah, I do too.
Okay. No, head's nodding, yes.
Yes.
Yeah, I agree.
That was a good one. Okay.
And actually, before that, we do have a comment for clarification from from Victor.
Yes.
On page 1.
Right.
Inquiring as to whether or not the definition of commercial would include industrial grounds. And I believe that there is some, this comment is based upon the fact that the property that they're interested in does have an industrially zoned portion.
Right.
Now, this is a mixture of commercial and residential uses, so it doesn't necessarily speak to the zoning
of the land. Victor, would that help? Does that help to address the concern? Or is it the intent that you would, I don't want to say you want, but you would be concerned if the MXD zone did not address industrial uses?
Mostly mechanical, it's not a big development issue, but mechanically there are going to be, not just the vet property, but there are going to be some pieces that are in town because there is some scattered zoning mm-hmm. in different places. I know there's somebody bringing a fabrication shop, right? They're going to be on Twin Arches, but there are going to be people that may bring businesses here. And whether it's a 90-acre piece or a 2-acre piece or a small piece, we want to make sure that all of the potential uses that can contribute to the business climate can be included in MXD if that's the way the Planning Commission wants to do it. So if commercial includes industrial and any type of ground so that you can apply this where you want it to, then it's not a problem. But I just wouldn't want to create we should have included this definition because now we can't apply this zone to some, particular property that we like. That was, going to happen.
And does that concern originate because the uses are so specifically enumerated?
What's eligible to be called MXD by the town? More eligibility.
You're talking about what the property is currently zoned as, not what you want it to become.
Correct.
Right.
Right. What can you apply the MXD as a planning commission? What can you apply it to?
Right. Right.
Rather than
rather than making it become industrial as
right.
part of MXD.
Correct.
Yes.
Yeah. If there's an industrial piece, yeah. even if it's an acre, and you want to make it an MXD piece.
You should be able to do
it. I just want to make
right.
sure that the definition allows.
Do you see what he means?
Yes. Yeah. Right. I see what he means.
Yeah. But do we want that? Yes.
Yes.
Okay. I think so.
Because the part of the Beck property they're looking at has...
And then this ordinance is not just the Beck property. So,
right.
Well, it's saying... Well, it's a good question. Yes. What do we want? Well, we can always... It's not a requirement that we say yes to someone who has an industrial property. Is that what you're...
Yeah.
Okay. Well, maybe it should be something where if the property has multiple zones, like this property mm-hmm. has...
Well, since we have a representative from...
I'm going to just give you an observation.
Yeah, yeah, let's hear what it is.
You've got a lawyer here and all this. Your whereas section is your intent section. What is your intent? And so this, I read, again, I'm a semi-former zoning administrator, so I have had plenty of experience in this. This is really just laying out the intent. It's saying that the town feels that it doesn't have a mixed use. And that it's got singular uses of commercial and residential. It's just illustrative of why you want to address the issue. So in this particular first one, it's just laying out why you're taking action on this. That's an important step of building the case. And someone later on says, you shouldn't be doing this, and you've laid out why you're doing it. And so this first one is just really just a declarative of why you're actually wanting to establish a mixed use zone. That's mine.
And
then
it speaks to the actual uses, not
right.
the zoning of property.
Right.
But that's not in what he's saying is that would come later in the ordinance. This is just.
Well, this is just
whereas.
Right.
But there are other elements
right.
that you refer to them. So I just refer making a parallel throughout the document. And again, it's just so that the town can include any property they want to in the zoning. If you feel that commercial is comprehensive enough to cover that, then that's fine. I just wouldn't want someone who had any piece, small, just an industrial piece, for example. If the town wanted them to do that, then it would be up to the town to be able to say yes, but it shouldn't be true.
I think that right now, if somebody's going to want some sort of a industrial type of business, like we were talking about the metal shop, that's going to go in the industrial zone. I don't see where...
That's the use.
But I mean...
Are there properties, for example, in the town center that may have an industrial use that anyone foresees could be part of town center redevelopment just for example, in the historic area, or even on Center Street?
Not in the historic area, absolutely not.
No.
No, we're not doing, no.
He's talking about property that's currently zoned industrial that would become MXD commercial slash residential, not that would become,
okay,
not that would have an industrial use.
Heather, would 1010 South Main fit into that?
Yeah, I was actually wondering about that, but I'm not.
Would 1010 South Main fit into that? Because
it's
It's
the one behind the carnival grounds.
That's plant. Right, that's paint.
But I mean, that's industrial.
Yeah, it is. Or yes, you're right.
Currently.
It is.
Yeah,
it is
currently. That was an example.
Okay.
He was asking for a change.
Yeah, he wanted to change that.
No, I understand. I'm just saying that would be an example of what
you're
talking about. So I don't know, we haven't actually discussed that, so we might have to
Okay, so we're just going to put this one aside right now. We're just going to put it in the parking lot and hopefully it'll, I'm sorry, is that not what you wanted, Heather?
No, I'm in my head.
Okay, we're gonna put this, we're gonna keep on going.
Yep.
Okay.
Yep.
Back to, we're back on next, Any other comments other than we're back to Bill? Let's go back to Bill. Okay.
Well, there's one on 3 of 17. I mean, do you want to go through it?
Yeah, it's almost like we have all these pages all out. That's what I'm looking at.
Right.
I've got the ordinance, and then I've got Bill, I've got Melissa, I've got KCA brothers.
Guides us because it's actually in the document.
Right.
But I don't want to miss... well, Bill's next comment isn't until page 7.
Right.
Okay, so, so then in 2 of 17, there's a whereas on second paragraph, there's a question mark.
No, that is Tom and I.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay, so that's,
That's a carrier highlight.
Okay.
So on 3 of 17.
Yeah. Okay.
We have, and this is a comment that the Katz brothers articulated in our previous discussions, that we, if there's not an opportunity to provide a certain site element, are we all on 3 of 17?
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
okay.
Yes,
we are. Just to make sure.
Thanks for checking.
That not all redevelopment sites, you know, would be able to comply with this, or it's not applicable. So, and that's...
That makes sense.
Well, what they're asking is to include the language as applicable, and I would disagree with that because I think that it can be a, we'll assume that it's going to work, and that if it doesn't, then, you know, they show us why it doesn't work, and it's, you know, we have a pattern book and everything. But I think that
I agree.
We leave it as it is, and that if there's a problem, you can explain and prove it and all that.
Okay. That would be fine. Nodding yes on that one?
I agree.
Okay. Okay, yeah. So got that one. Okay, next.
Because the intent is to include it.
Yeah. Okay, next, 4 of 17, unless I'm missing again.
I'm not clear where our comments are going.
What's wrong?
There, the highlighted.
I know, but we also have Melissa, the comments.
Well, that's it, I don't want to miss.
So Bill's on page 7, but Melissa's are done with the statutory sites. So she mentioned, but I made comments on most of hers, so, and I don't think
okay. All right.
So if we go to Melissa's, see, we're just this lucky to have this many comments. So 2 of 17, Melissa shares that under 2J.
Yeah, it should be outdoor.
Which is
2 of 17.
No, on page 3 of 17, it's 2J.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, okay.
2J.
Yeah, I'm going to pound them.
The location, the sidewalk displays?
Mm-hmm.
Said it would be outdoor displays instead of sidewalk because...
Okay.
Sometimes it's not a sidewalk.
Right. Just
to be a little bit of a broader stuff.
Any issue with that? So
it's a good point.
Yeah.
It's good semantics.
And then I think later she's got that just the same thing, but further along.
Okay.
All right. That's that.
Okay. So now we're on to page 4.
No,
and what's the signage plan? But that was 5A, that's still the same.
Yeah, okay, so she's, so Melissa's got page.
Melissa is 5A, and Victor is.
I've already crossed it out.
5A3.
Yeah. Okay, so let's go with Melissa first. So, I'm sorry, what'd you say?
So it's page 4, and it's number 5.
5A.
And she just wants us to take out the phrase that's redundant. A signage plan for the mixed-use development shall be included in the pattern book. When we already know it will be included because it's listed.
Oh, okay, got it. Okay, got it. Everyone agree with that one?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Okay, so now we're on to Victor's comment, right?
Yep.
Who's ready about that?
Okay, so this is highlighting that, and we run into this, you know, a lot when we have a new, brand-new building, that tenants often have specific signage requirements because of their corporate logo and branding. What I would ask is that, is it in, the premise for this, this ordinance is that it's very, it's design-based. So would there be a general theme for signage that, you know, whether it be like all, you know, channel set lettering, or it would be indirectly lit, there would not be that component known up front as to the, I guess, sign design, like throughout the, I'm looking at Craig. Craig is.
Craig's your opinion on that.
Actually, I'll let, because he's done a project already that, you know, would be able to tell, but it's very hard. There are certain signs that I know that you can, I can say, this is where the entrance signs could be, this is where we want to have.
Right.
Directional signs, you know, this store is this way, this way. You can do certain things like that.
Okay.
But number 3 really speaks to something that I would not pretend to be, which is marketing guru for whatever company is, you know, building within our subdivision or our project or something like that. So whereas a strip center may have a lot of the neon lights or the big blocky letters across, you know, I don't think a town center has that. There's a lot of different character signs to a town center. A real good example is the Crown Farm. You can go to Crown Farm, and there are some very traditional signs that tell you where to go.
Right.
But one of the restaurants, Coastal Flats, has some really interesting, you know, like old-time signs across the, it's the theme of that restaurant. The one across the way has different script signs, but it's the theme for that restaurant. So, and they're all flat wall signs or murals, things like that. So I don't know how you.
That early in the process?
Yeah, that early in the process. I know that you guys look at signs a lot, though, so it can be done. I just don't know if it can be done that early.
So let me ask you this. In our proposed sign ordinance, there is a section where we require a master sign plan for individual buildings. Is that something that you feel would be able to be, you know, presented at that particular time? So it, rather than upfront in the pattern book?
I think so. I mean, every building is going to go through a building permit process. And that building permit process can also go through the sign approval of what's going on in those buildings. And clearly, if it's, there are separate buildings within a redevelopment project, you know, you'll be able to see whether they look alike or whether they contrast with each other. You'll be able to see those as those permits come through. But I think that's, that is a good time.
Okay.
When those buildings are being built or designed and being looked at by the town, you can do it at that time.
Just to reiterate, that's, again, as the buildings are being developed and designed, the signage is going to be sort of part and parcel to that design of the building.
Okay.
You know, I've been to Crown as well. And, you know, one building might have something very traditional, but catty corner from it might be something very modern because it fits that particular restaurant or that building. But it's a nice eclectic mix, and when you take the streetscape in whole, it's great. But to try and say that these MXD developments are going to stick to this block letter on a backlit sign, that doesn't apply here. We want the character, the differences, so that you end up with something that doesn't look like it's, you know, a strip box center. So you want, the one challenge that we all face in commercial is when you lease to a national chain. You guys have dealt with that as well.
Absolutely.
You know, they have standards that they want to impose as well. That's where there could be a little bit of, back and forth. But I think that, again, seeing the pictures that they provided and the projects we've done, even next door, good example, you know, the signage really goes with the building.
Right.
You're not going to just all of a sudden just, you know, plaster up, you know, some crazy sign that would be on a different type of building. So, but I don't know how you capture this here, you know, that you all are comfortable, but...
Well, we're going to have in the sign ordinance, which we'll eventually have, there is that master plan. There is that master plan for the signs there. So I think that this, I'm fine with taking this.
Right, but still, that master plan is going to be in. I think we need to put it in individual building. It's not going to go through a whole. You're not going to be able to get a master plan for the entire center at one time. It's going to go building by building.
And that's important to remember when we continue our discussions on the sign ordinance.
Okay. So we agree with this one.
Yeah.
So all of section 5 is gone? Because there is no signage plan.
Would there be a, like, a development sign?
Not necessarily. I mean, I'll speak for me, but not necessarily, because if you're incorporating an infill property into several different road crossings and whatever, you want it to seamlessly flow with what's already there, not necessarily create a block that says you've arrived somewhere else.
Uh-huh.
You know, we're trying to create more of a continuity in a lot of these properties. Now, that's different than if it happens to be an MXD shopping center, or it's a standalone on its own. Mm-hmm. There it may be appropriate. But if it's a property that's intertwined with existing road network, we dealt with this at Raincliff, the project we showed you. I brought the pattern book tonight.
I made some copies.
So if anybody wants to see it. Town of Sykesville was very adamant. They did not want monumentation to separate that project from the rest of the town. They wanted it to feel like it was just another, you know, block within the town.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So.
Okay, so
they may or may not apply, I guess.
So, would there be a comfort level just to notate that the signage plan will be handled under town code and zoning regulations?
Yes.
Okay.
So we sort of have that there in 4B.
Mm-hmm.
Just
so we will just strike A.
Yeah.
And then just modify the language in B.
Okay.
Can we refer to that?
Okay.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, what's next?
Yeah,
I know. Okay. Make your notes first. So we all know. Okay, so we basically were saying to refer to a signed master plan or something like that.
Right.
You can make it nicer. Okay. Okay. Well, Heather's still making notes.
Going. Melissa has this comment. It's the next page, 5017.
Uh huh.
You may want to allow for, enable them to have a signage plan or something if they want to proffer that or want to propose that, that's slightly different than your regulations as a whole for allowing them to have the flexibility. If you want to promote flexibility, they don't have to necessarily establish, but they want to establish something that's slightly different than your normal sign codes, and they want to give you a package at the time that you're going through this that would deviate from the normal sign standards. That's a potential for allowing for the developer to actually get some flexibility that they may not see that they have in the regulation, but creating, again, a unifying concept. Again, so you may want to allow for enable it, but not mandate it. Something of that nature.
Let me think about it. Heads nodding on that? Heather, how can you write that one up?
Call
See me later.
Yeah, I'm going to say call Chuck.
Okay. Sounds good.
And then call Chuck.
But is there a consensus to work that in?
Yeah.
Let's draft it and see.
Yep.
Thank you.
So we're not calling it required, but we're saying you can.
Yes.
Offering the flexibility. And that's.
That's a requirement to enable it.
That's what this whole, you're right, and that's what this whole.
Thing is about.
To be receptive to the proposal.
Yeah. Okay. So I know you guys found a problem. Okay. So while Heather's making notes, we're back to 5 and 17. What did you say, Leslie, now?
I was trying to find Melissa's comment, but it's really just kind of a grammatical comment. Because it says those persons, so I want something that doesn't say those persons. Those persons or those equals.
That was Melissa's, yeah.
Yeah, so I haven't actually found specificity somewhere.
3C?
Four.
So maybe it's something.
Or comment four.
It's a C. Top of page six.
D.
Little C.
Oh, okay. So just correct that typo.
Yeah, it's just a typo.
Okay.
Those persons.
Okay, so now we're back over to, page 5 of 17, and it's 7 little b.
And 7b is not a comment. That's
a leftover from you and Tom?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, so we're concentrating on, in the yellows, anything that has BK.
And then Bill's and Melissa's.
Yeah.
Okay. So now.
Yeah. Good. We're not to Bill yet. This is page 7.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, we're not to Bill yet. Okay. So now we're at Victor D1.
You're saying there should be a mechanism so that they don't have to at the staff level for non-material changes.
We totally agree with that.
Yeah.
I would. I mean, the point of this actually, this happened in Montgomery County, if anyone's familiar with Clarksburg Town Center.
Mm-hmm.
Plans were approved, changes were made by the staff, and they were material changes, and then in the opinion of many people, and it created a moratorium for about a year in the county. So the county did actually a pretty comprehensive look-see of, okay, we don't want to send everything back through the site plan, but what do we want to send through? And those might be a good reference to see what standards are material and what standards are not. Because clearly, you know, adding more units, making something 50 feet tall or whatever you want to call it, are material. But you know, changing the grade of a curb may not be planning commission worthy. So I think maybe the Montgomery County standards on what is material and what's not for site plan might be useful as a reference.
And is that actually, did they codify that, or was it just like a policy document?
I'm not sure.
Okay.
If it's one or the other, but I know it's been a much quieter and much a smoother process over the last couple of years because of that. So it may be a policy.
We would, as staff, definitely want that determined as to where that comfort level is.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So how do you, I mean,
okay.
Let's see if we
can. So I think it's a yes, but we need to get the same answer.
Yeah. Yeah. Let's reach
out to Montgomery County and see if we can get that guidance. Take a look.
Did you get Bill's comments on that?
Mm-hmm. I did. Thank you.
Okay.
That's why you were invited.
Here for this.
You're sitting here. I'm going to
foresee a problem later on. Because I know there's been some lawsuits on this issue of who submits an application for an amendment.
Mm-hmm.
Once it's approved, once it's halfway through the development process, who owns the development? Who can submit an amendment to that development? It's best that you try to address that before you have the development. I think the one in Frederick is Warman's Mill.
Mm-hmm.
So now it's a lawsuit, and I don't know if it's been settled yet.
They'd like to avoid that.
But the HOA says they own the development. The developer still has a portion of it. He says he owns the development. And so who has the right to make an amendment? Who has to be an approving, a part of an applicant to a development along the way? you may want, because these planned developments or these unified developments, they live longer than every one of us. And so you may want to try to define that as best you can. And again, I have no answer for this one. I just know that this is a real problem later on when you have these developments, and it's best to incorporate some components about reapprovals and who's the applicant and those kinds of things along the way. Again, I don't have a solution for you for this thing, but But this is really a problem later on. So just imagine, approve a development, it's halfway through the project, they've subdivided all pieces of property, and there's people that love it, and the leftover piece, they say, market's changed, I want to come back and submit a reapproval. Well, and they've sold the development to another person along the way. Mm-hmm. You have multiple changes, and it happens. Mm-hmm. At that point, someone submits an application. Are they the real applicant of that development? Mm-hmm. And so you really have to kind of think about, and you may have to say, well, we're putting it in place right now, and everyone's on notice that you got to either sign off of your adjacent properties, or 50% of the people have to sign in, or each one's on their own, whatever it is. But you're kind of like at the beginning of it, and so you haven't had the first approval development going through the process. You have the ability to set the rules so that you won't have the warrants build developments later on, hopefully.
Okay, that's a
Tom
question then.
I think Tom's working
on
that now.
Okay, thank you.
I don't know. I think this is all subdivided up. The question is, can you take about ownership? The problem about it is, it was originally owned, it got subdivided, it got sold off.
Yeah.
That piece of property is no longer owned by the original person anymore, and do they have a say?
Right.
It's a sticky wicket. Yeah. It's not something that I have an answer for you by any means. It's something. Find the court case.
But I think that if the parts of the master plan property are carved off to different owners, that owner, when he takes title, is subject to the site plan requirements there.
Right.
If he at that point decides he wants to make a change, it's on him to come back to them.
And I don't disagree with you with that, but that should be said in there that the property owner later on owns that piece of property. He has the ability to apply for an amendment, and he doesn't need to get other people's permission along the way. So that issue just needs to be clearly stipulated up front. So later on, the residents say, oh no, we bought this development based upon that being the way it is, and this property over here is now saying, well, market doesn't support that. I want to change that. Do you need their approval or not? I don't really care which way.
Yeah, no.
I just think you should kind of put the rules out there so everyone knows right ahead.
Yeah, no,
I agree with you. Thank you.
We would like staff to be able to deal with that because we were just talking about it in December. Well, we're not going to have a meeting.
No.
I don't know who staff is.
The adult staff.
We're going to research their standards.
Okay.
And just to follow up with what he's saying, Dave Carlsox and I had talked about this. How long does the pattern book standard apply to something? All of that is relevant to what he was saying, because even a restaurant may want to change its look. Do they go back through the entire process? Or, so I think that's a really good thing to look at, how those standards and who can make the changes or applications.
A prescriptive instead of permissive approach to signage, excuse me, to echo some of your discussion from previously, is also going to wind up creating that type of dilemma down the road. The beauty of these things is that the watchword of them is flexibility. And it's a design-driven concept that's collaboratively developed. The collaboration being between the private energy of the developer and the landowner, and the town's representatives, your government's representatives, to try to achieve something that works for this parcel. in some parcels, the industrial uses or industrial land would be a perfect fit. Others, they won't. There was also a similar comment I saw about pedestrian and bicycle paths. In some projects, they're going to be an incredible dynamic, and others are not going to work so well. So if the watchword here is flexibility and something that's designed, you also want the flexibility to allow the project to grow. Because let's say you've got, and Robert touched on one of the things that I was thinking of, particularly with signage. Signage, whether it's a national, regional, what have you, becomes so much a part of a brand or a signature for particular kinds of businesses. And what works for one is not going to be what the successor to that space is going to want to do. The same kind of thing, I think, you may want to explore for who gets to make the changes. Just an idea I'll throw out is perhaps if you're looking at this, and I don't want to make it more complicated than the scale of Mount Airy requires, but if you're going to talk about a comprehensive planning document, you may want to also elect to approach that document in a phased or component or sectional kind of an approach, so that if you've got a combination condominium and duplex or town residential component, and then you've got one that's downtown shopping or mixed office residential, you don't want to have one necessarily wed to the other when there needs to be changes. Mm-hmm. The economy is going to continue to change over time.
Good point.
And so you may want to look at a sectional approach.
Good point.
Thank you. Okay. Thanks for that. And keep on jumping in. We need to still want to get through this. Okay, so we're back to
page five.
Okay, page five. So we talked about,
there's some kind of an incomplete sentence, number two, underneath Victor's yellow, now that paragraph below.
What I put in there is there are a lot of parentheticals in the document.
Yeah, that's what drew my attention to the paragraph.
Yeah. There's a lot of important stuff that are actually in parentheses. And usually parentheses mean sort of aside and not as important, but they are as important in a lot of places here. So just from a form standard, and I'm sure all the lawyers in here are enjoying this part.
That's why Leslie said no.
Yeah, most of those
parentheticals. I like you, but I'm not paying them.
Most of should probably be taken out. Unless they are, you know, referring to something else. Because they are important elements of what you're trying to say.
Well, I'll read the sentence. All plans shall be prepared by a licensed architect, registered civil engineer, professional landscape architect, or other qualified architect. Information for the submission.
Yeah.
And then there's the IE concept plans are more general, but it's still...
I just remember that was the Hoffman. Yeah, Hoffman. Sorry, they had wanted to say that they didn't want to, they wanted to be able to have anyone. I think that's what it was.
Something that was there, we took it out, but we didn't change the rest of it or something. But yeah,
Heather, do you remember this? Or? That's what I remember. Yeah. But then
that's where you'd be there.
That's exactly what occurred.
Yeah. Okay, so now how do we make this right or make it sound right?
It was, I think in the beginning, it was like in subcommittee form that they're, just to talk about the integrity of the plan that we're considering. So is there, and I don't know if we ever discussed it as far as requiring, so would there be a lesser requirement for the concept plan? Currently, our site plan process do require engineered, a professional, a Ron drawing.
So I don't understand why, again, you already have it in the code.
Right.
It doesn't really matter. It has to be a licensed professional.
Right.
Done. Right?
I'm not certain why we felt it was important to
But it made sense at the time, I believe.
And now it doesn't.
I mean, you're reiterating what your code already said, which is fine, but you already require licensed professionals to do the work. And it goes beyond concept plans, preliminary plans, final plans. There's construction plans, there's a lot of other architectural, a lot of the plans. You already require professionals, so.
So then we should just take out the sentence, all plans shall be prepared by?
The IE, the example, right?
But we're saying our code all requires the plans to be prepared by a PD, so why are we saying it again?
I'll give you an observation. My recommendation is to, if things are like in all different areas of your code, don't put different specifications here than there, because you're one, if you decide to change it there, you then need to change it everywhere.
Right.
And so if you do have a provision that says all your plan submissions must be by professionals, that's all that's said once and it's applicable here as it is everywhere, so you don't even need that. And I'll make the same observation about your notice requirements. If this is a different notice requirement than anywhere else, then it's fine. But if you're drawing special attention to this, and then later on you say, we need to get more notification, then you're changing it to multiple places. So you may want to ask yourself, if I have a section that just deals with notifications, you just refer to that notification section, and then you don't have to go into detail. So again, I didn't look for
that. That makes sense.
No, he's looking at it. But we've been dealing with this for
years.
2-3 years. Yeah. So it just is what it is at this point.
Yeah. Okay.
So just an observation. If you're repeating yourself, then you haven't covered your code elsewhere. Don't.
Right.
So okay. For the purposes of that paragraph too, you really talk about just eliminating that one sentence. All
yes.
All plans shall be prepared.
That's what I'm proposing.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
Just
yeah.
Drop that out.
That sounds good.
And my comment was to take the parenthetical off the sentence.
Right.
Concept plans are more general than preliminary.
And that will just go away with that.
No, because they're unrelated. I think it's important to state that concept plans are more general than preliminary.
Oh, so just make that
they have a definition.
Make it a statement and not a parent. Not
no, no, okay. Okay. Take it out of the
parent. They have a definition somewhere else, yeah.
Okay.
Is it a defined term in your code as a chapter?
There's a defined process.
There's a checklist that says what you have to do.
Yeah, which in the code
in itself.
It's not a singular general definition, but it's.
There is a requirement that has a checklist.
Right.
So it's already defined.
Okay, so I'm
maybe
back to
just reference that provision. Mm-hmm.
Don't even need it, we only have it if it's already a requirement.
Right.
So, okay, we're back to take the whole thing up, right? Okay. Going once, going twice.
And then we need to refer to the other code.
Okay.
Is the public hearing different?
Is the notice of the public hearing different?
Is the notice different? Did we say?
Or is that the notice that we have for all of them?
We have 15 days.
We do not require a notice for the site plan.
Right.
Right.
So that's right. Okay.
Right.
Okay.
So this is specific.
So that's good.
So this is specific. Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
Right.
Yep.
Thank you.
Thank you.
This has been too long.
I know. Okay. Can we turn the page?
Yeah.
So it's number 3 staying 3A and all those notices?
Yes.
Those
yeah, because
staying.
That's...
Yeah, because this is something different from what we currently have. Yeah. Okay, we turn the page. Yay. So, okay. We've got...
Almost halfway through. That's awesome.
So C is persons. We know that we've already made that change.
Okay. So, 6, page 6, and then C. Miss Melissa.
Yep.
Those persons.
Yeah, I think we took care of that. Melissa, the reason that we do have it the way it is because we intentionally are eliminating the types of businesses that can have drive-throughs to the 4 that are mentioned.
Are you jumping to the next?
Melissa's coming.
She was up here. She.
We already changed that.
Yeah.
We already changed that.
Yeah. We're done.
Right. I do understand that. I guess disagree with the limitations for the drive-through because of limiting the possibilities of
something that you might really like as a drive-through instead of just, you know, kind of singularly looking at it as the typical.
We've talked about it for a very long time.
We've driven through the drive-thru enough
times.
Later, when the kids shop at the drive-thru, then you can come back and try to get it amended.
Try real hard, and I can't get them to do drive-thru.
You're welcome.
But after the night, there might be one.
Pennsylvania. You go to Pennsylvania.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, so we're cool. This is cooler, at least 5C is taking.
It's not cool, yeah.
It's not cool, but it's done. So we're parking that drive-thru long enough. Okay, so
before you go on, Heather, I just want to make sure. I can't remember, and I couldn't find my notes about the all the other stuff, the drive-thrus. Did we actually have it in the language before about them being on the outer portions of the...
The ends of the building?
Yeah,
I thought we did.
We did at one point.
Yes, at one point.
We did what? We said it at one point.
Checked off in the... This, remember the heart, the paracord?
Yeah.
We have it incorporated.
Oh, we just don't have it here. Okay, that's right.
Okay.
Because I know you and I didn't do it because I've been really busy and I'm sure you've been really busy.
No, I don't want it because...
Okay, so it's just not all
it's like 20 right. development yeah. standards, so...
Right, and we're not doing all that.
Okay.
Yeah.
Basically, everything's not in this draft.
Got it.
Right. Okay. Right. E on 6 of 17 E. It doesn't include the Hereford.
Whatever. Okay. So we're just missing. So we're missing Hereford. Okay.
We just need to.
All right. Got it.
Streamline that.
Okay. Cool. Okay.
All right.
I lost it. Okay. So now we turn the page to 7 of 17.
Seven. Yes.
Okay. And then seven,
we have
Mr. Bill. Okay.
Standards.
Okay. Let's do Victor first, and then we'll go to Mr. Bill.
Does this have issues on the finder? What plan is this referring to? Is this referring to F or G?
His question.
Yeah.
F. Okay. Outdoor storage yourself.
So this is
site plan that Joey's going.
We followed up on this a couple meetings ago, and the plan is actually the site plan. Like when you're getting approval. And I think that Victor, you probably have some concern of that because the individual tenants might not be known, you might not know their actual needs for outdoor storage.
I'm not as concerned. This is more mechanical than the lawyer.
That is okay. Then I am not going to go into that.
Okay. So it's more that site plan is a very general term.
Okay.
Uncapitalized, it's a very general term. So if there's a specific plan you want to see it on that has a defined term from the town, just define or put that capitalized term in there so that people know, this is just to know when to do it.
Okay.
It's not a pattern book, right? It's not in it's at the site plan. That's fine. So let's just put capital S, capital P, and then you know that's where that is.
Okay.
The background on that was that you don't have these shopping centers like we have now where they just take over parking and create outdoor storage. That's where the bill.
Yeah.
Okay. So we do capital S.
Skids of pine bark and that kind of stuff.
Okay. So now, Mr. Bill's comment. Do we all agree? The capital S, capital P.
Yeah.
Okay.
And G, we can change the sidewalks back for the outdoor.
Yeah.
It's kind of consistent with Melissa's other comment. G.
Oh, so
sidewalk.
Oh, yeah.
All right. Yeah. Outdoor displays.
Okay. Yes.
But if it refers
G, seasonal sidewalk display should be seasonal outdoor displays. And just check out the word sidewalk one, please.
Yeah.
Heather, did you get that?
I did. I'm striking sidewalk and putting outdoor.
Great.
Yep.
Great. Okay. Now we're
to Mr. Bill.
Yay. I'm sorry. The outdoor display, which I think is the right way, but that last sentence may be problematic. There are going to be some outdoor displays, like holiday displays, that are called outdoor displays on sidewalks that may or may not want to be removed after hours. I just don't know if you should make that a requirement, a decoration. decorations. Christmas tree, whatever you're going to do, you know, sleigh, whatever. There may be things that
pumpkin.
It's not practical to take in every
We don't have people do that now.
Do you want to put this in mixed use ordinance, or just deal with this as a your separate seasonal display? I'm just asking the question.
We don't have anything to deal with
outside of this. Again, if you're trying to deal with specifically your mixed use district versus seasonal displays can be applied outside of this area too. So is it unique to this particular one, or is this just a seasonal function elsewhere throughout the town? And I raise that question in drawing the distinction between the two.
I think where the discussion originates from is there's a condition that happens now that it makes things look a little clutter.
Well, you got
there was a desire to perhaps make these, especially because they're going to share their land area with residential units.
I don't disagree. You make it more challenging for flexibility. And again, they quite frankly will have their own private covenants and those things that are those deals amongst themselves that you may not want government to get involved in those things. Again, it's an enforcement issue. Anything you put in here, don't put it in here if you're not going to enforce it.
So let's take it out then.
I have a feeling that there's two different kinds of things that we're talking about. One is the Ace Hardware and the mulch in the parking lot. Okay, but up on the sidewalk, they'll have lawnmowers that are all chained together, lawnmowers and wheelbarrows and that kind of stuff. And that stays on the sidewalk. Sometimes it goes in, sometimes it doesn't.
Right.
You know, so and same with Southern States, they'll have lawnmowers and the same type of thing and flowers.
Right. But
so Walmart.
So are we talking, and then Walmart does too. So are we talking that type of thing, or are we talking the mulch all out in the parking lot?
Well, I think you have to look at it as each shopping center has its own covenants too. So that's governed by the covenants in the shopping center, and I agree, we don't want to add another way. Whatever their covenants is going to be, their covenants is going to be. Because we have enough trouble now with things, you know, somebody will say, well, so-and-so has this, so why can't I have, you know, kind of spoiled kid thing. I think that we need to just take it out and let the covenants of the shopping center or the town center deal with it.
I apologize. You need to be careful only in operational aspects. The zoning ordinance deals to do with uses and the actual occupancy of that operation initially.
Good point.
Right.
The tractors and all of those things, those are operational things that you can have pass separate ordinances. And again, code enforcement, God love you. Those kinds of things are, but again, if they're in violation, are you going to revoke their site plan and tell them to close the building? So you have to be able to distinguish where is this in terms of occupancy of the structure versus ongoing operations. And try to not conflate things. You will not solve all your problems in this one ordinance. I can assure you that.
I think that's what we're trying to do.
Never happened. You want to be focused on what you're trying to achieve here solely.
So should we go ahead and just take out the last two sentences? No sidewalk displays should be printed after the, associated with the public or continue past 9 p.m. The sidewalk displays shall be removed from the sidewalk after hours. Just take off those two sentences. Thank you. That's the definition of operational. That's really good.
We needed
you a long time ago.
We didn't have that sense of clarity about it.
Do you not, though, take off the beginning part?
Why
would you keep that, though? Because that's operational again.
It is. It's the whole, that G
that
is all.
That paragraph should just go.
I agree, Jim.
Remember that this particular subsection falls not under our zoning ordinance, but is proposed to fall under Chapter 98. So what we're looking at here is, yes, it's operational, and I wholeheartedly agree. I do not like operational stuff getting in the zoning ordinance. But just remember, this section that you're looking at here is Chapter 98 section, not a Chapter 112 section.
Okay.
So now what do we do?
So what do you, what do you advise on then? Do we keep it in there?
I mean, you still come back to, the comment's still valid, and that is, if you're not going to enforce it, don't have it in there. I'm just making the point that if the reason you take it as, because you don't think it's appropriate in zoning ordinance, this is not a zoning ordinance. This is a part of the subdivision.
Can I say the first two sentences and take
this, is not, this section here is not the zoning ordinance?
Correct. Okay. This subsection that we're dealing with here is a part of the subdivision plan process. But the rest of the comments are still valid.
So, but is it in the, there's the police powers that are not your zoning that are dealing with health safety, you know, clearing of sidewalks from snow removal, all those kinds of things. That's not zoning. That's so. These kinds of things fit into that, and if it's that part of your municipal code, cool. That's fine. It's an appropriate place for it.
I agree with you.
I don't think we have a section, and I agree with that. I don't think we have a section dealing with seasonal displays now, and if you want to deal with them, it seems to me the considerations that you might have to bring this about in mixed use apply generally, and maybe that needs to be addressed by the town council in a section on code enforcement or something along those lines, rather than kind of, right.
Well, it's not an issue.
Okay. So what is the pleasure of the commission?
We were going to leave the first two. We were thinking of leaving the first two
sentences. Sentences.
Yeah.
And I think so.
Yeah. For now.
Right.
For G, you're talking.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. I think so. I agree. Leave the first couple.
It's guidance. It's not operational.
Okay.
So
we would
strike from the words no sidewalks.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay, so the next under B, that's you're in Tom still. Will there be an additional separate parking standards that need to be added, Heather?
Yeah, I'm going to look towards our town engineer at this time because he would be appropriate to comment on that.
You thought you would get out of this easy.
I know.
Mixed use.
Let me make a comment, Heather.
Yes, sir.
Let me make a comment here. That was my next comment on my page. You've got to consider the impact of parking in any mixed use. And so I think there needs to be some words in there that gives the Planning Commission some idea of what to ask when a developer comes in. So I suggest the two sections. One.
Yeah, did you see that? That was good.
Absolutely. And with that, along with Mr. McCullough's comments, just referring to our town code, and we have it highlighted because I haven't received guidance from our town engineer just to see if this situation would be any different than anything we already have prescribed under our parking ordinance.
My initial thought is that we would just follow what our ordinance already says, because you address each building, or similar to the way the code's written now, we have like a mixed use retail in our parking ordinance now. We have residential in the parking, and you would just treat each site as it comes along. So I don't know that you need to develop something separately.
Okay.
I think it depends on.
There are a lot of hands lying up back there.
I think it depends
on the goal, because Mr. McCullough, he's got the structured parking wrapped, being not visible from the street. And I think we had just some other stuff, at least previously in there, about that. That's very different than our current parking ordinance. It would seem to be more consistent with
the vision.
And
this is really, if we incorporated this is really the only more prescriptive design criteria that this code would have. And I think it's very thoughtful and meaningful
could jump in.
Two things. As it pertains to the current, I haven't looked at it all the time, but my recollection is that, and we probably would have dealt with this downtown, which we haven't yet, will. The parking standards really were never thought to address condominiums or rental housing. So when you have a loft, basically one open room flat, or you have a one bedroom apartment or condo, or a two bedroom, that's a different impact from a parking perspective than a townhome or a single family home. So I think we need to explore that. And I think I've said all along, since we started this, parking ultimately is going to drive density across the board, because you got to park at the building. So those standards are very important, but they are going to, at the end of the day, dictate what the parking requirement ultimately gives in retail or commercial and residential. So that's my first point. So I don't think we deal with that in a specific way for other types of housing other than the traditional housing we've had here in the past.
We do, now Rob, and this might not be what you're referring to, but we do have a residential apartment parking calculation of two spaces per unit. We do have on our task list to entertain a reduced parking standard for what would be considered an efficiency unit.
Exactly.
Of just
so that's
one
what I was,
parking
that's really,
space.
If it's okay. A two-bedroom apartment, I think you look across at other jurisdictions, they deal with these more regularly. They do have a different standard for those types of residential units, be it a one-bedroom or a two-bedroom or a three-bedroom for that matter.
And I think we look at square footage as being the difference for between like a one-bedroom or two-bedroom.
Yeah, but square footage doesn't really dictate who's there.
It's gonna make a difference in the markability of the complex.
Or what the real impact is.
Yeah.
The other thing is with mixed use, you're going to have more opportunity for the shared parking.
Yes.
Yes.
So I can see when people are out during the day, there other people are there, you know, shopping or doing other things. And so that's where that really kicks in, which we already have written in the code.
Well, actually, that brings up a good point, and it has to do with the standards themselves. Some of the standards that we're looking at are meant to be standalone projects. If this was a 5-acre square of a piece of property, this is how many spaces we want, because people are going to come and go from here in a certain defined way. A town center project, MXD project in the town center, however you want to call it, one of the big elements is it's a pedestrian-oriented project. Is it necessary to require, I'm just saying, require the same number of spaces for the exact same products that you would on a satellite property? I think the comment is very, very correct in that whoever's developing their site is going to park it to make sure it's successful. No one's going to put, you know, 100,000 square feet of commercial and put six parking spots. But the standards that may be existing now for the sites may not be as applicable to town center pedestrian-oriented things. So I think it is important to take a look again at the standards and see, again, maybe an adjacent, whether it's Montgomery County or Frederick County, how they've dealt with, if they've changed, if they've made any revisions or anything to parking standards as they apply specifically to those types of town center projects.
Again, could you just put in a provision allowing for a development to submit a parking proposal that provides all of that documentation that, again, allows for the flexibility and the range of mixed uses and the variations, and they submit a proposal to you and say, hey, we looked at your standards, we're going to submit something that's slightly different. You review it, you get your engineer to look at it, and you ultimately say, we approve this and we modify the standards for parking for this mixed-use development based upon the submissions. And again, it's flexible based upon, you know, evolution of park. You know, millennials drive less, they don't need the cars as much, Uber is becoming more popular. And so we don't know what the parking standards will be.
Good point.
5 years from now.
Good point.
We know that they're less than they were 10 or 15 years ago, which is what all of the engineering studies are based upon.
Right.
So you want to provide a flexible tool for consideration when projects come forward here.
Heather, do we already have...
I don't know if it's in your code already.
Yeah, there might be some general provision already that allows the Planning Commission to look at something and deviate from that code. Is that already...
Well, when we did that for the East Ridgeville property, didn't we have...
From memory, I believe you're correct.
Hardship.
Hardship. If you have that, then again, you reference that.
But I don't think it would have to be a hardship.
No, it's different.
No, yeah, it's not a hardship.
It should be, allowing them to submit a proposal.
That was a hardship. We need...
Not a variance for provisions, but an actual allowing them to give you raw numbers, give you examples of other places that have done it, how you, and something that you can go and look at.
There may, I know there's something that's been discussed about design phases and other aspects of this. It would seem to me, instead of trying to figure out down the road how we park different components of a project, which we don't know what they are yet, you may want to move some of this discussion or allow it to be moved into that design kind of venue. You may have someone who wants to come in where you actually have mixed uses in a section of this or whatever. They may want to propose, instead of parking fixed individual users, you might want to see a campus-wide parking proposal or a central parking proposal for multiple users. Mm-hmm. That would, again, if we're looking at fostering a pedestrian-friendly pedestrian orientation, that certainly would seem to be, pointing in that direction. The thing that's nice about these projects, in order to make them work, is instead of having someone with a property they're interested in look at a code and have the code tells them what their property, the project, is going to look like, because if you've got this requirement, you've got this requirement for minimum lot width, this requirement, it kind of gets backwards, where the design comes in for the local government to review to determine whether or not that overall design really does work, given some of the real local peculiar dynamics of this community. For instance, you don't have public transportation. So obviously parking, you're going to have it, or else you've got to park to make it work. So yeah, you're going to have to do something like that. Once again, I think if you could create something that's permissive, if you will, instead of prescriptive, so that it would allow someone to come in at the design phase, not necessarily a hardship type variance, as I think Rob and some of the others were getting at, but as part of their overall design, you can have standards for, we feel we need parking of X, kind of a threshold or whatever, and let somebody come up with designs. They may go up, I don't know, instead of just going laterally or two-dimensional.
That's very constructive. Yeah.
So basically, what about, we say right now, we have a parking proposal, Heather, and so I do agree with what you're saying.
But we could entertain a parking proposal.
We just need some language.
Yeah, we need some language.
Well, if we start to adopt some of the criteria that Bill provided, only one of the things I noticed there about structure, if you got into structure, which you probably need to deal with, a lot of these projects, they can't wrap them completely.
Right.
And so, in that case, it goes back to the architecture properly, architecture designs. You don't have Baltimore, you have a lot of places you see them, and you turn down the side street, and the architecture is beautiful, and you kind of do a second look, and go, oh, that's a parking garage.
Right.
So, to be fully wrapped is probably unrealistic here in the scope of Mount Airy.
Right.
But certainly the architecture is still very important.
Andrea, you wanted to say something?
Kind of bits and pieces. I was going to say something. But I think it is really important when looking at examples of what can be, how Mount Airy can take different examples and apply in here. Mm-hmm. It's really important to take a pedestrian-friendly approach, but also putting it in a auto-centric world, like mm-hmm. being able to compare and do that delicate balance between both of them. And I was going to say the thing about there is no public transit, but also the fact of your proximity to 70 and all the other counties that are around here. I mean, a town center, you would want to draw from other places. Right. You don't just want to be here. So even though the pedestrian feeling is there, there's some properties within town that, you know, physically getting from one part of town to the other is impossible. So just have to, parking. I really like the idea of a general parking plan for the whole complex. Therefore allowing, it giving that, you know, overall sense that you're in a sense of place. And that it's cohesive and not just like just put together and not put together.
Yes.
In that section, it could kind of give you an either or. You can go with the standards of the town, parking uses, mm-hmm. or you can propose.
Put a purple
okay.
And it's a parking
plan. I like that.
Okay.
Right.
That's yeah, that's
project.
Awesome.
Because a small scale project may be perfectly fine.
Okay. Yeah. So
that, and
thank
I think
you.
That a lot of these. Very particular items will come into that design.
Right.
I don't think that there's a need to enumerate mm-hmm. each one as a mandate.
Are you looking, looking at bills?
So because some will work and some won't based on the design, mm-hmm. and I don't think it's worth it to go through each single one and say, well, what if you have a little 2-acre piece that's chopped off the corner, does it have to be parked in the back? Well, what if the MXD was for an industrial piece that's in a different part of town? You're going to tell them to do a town center look and then park it on the side. You know,
like
this gets really, there's a lot of if-thens that come into this.
Right, it's almost going against what we're saying as far as the flexibility.
But the spirit of what's in here, having, you know, like you said, that disguised parking, all of that is what you get to decide by looking at that parking plan. These
right.
are good elements. You just don't want to mandate them. You want to make them something that you want to see in a mm-hmm. review.
I don't have the code in front of me in terms of the regular parking, but I, without reviewing that again, I would be concerned with having that as an option.
Having
the regular parking
okay.
as an option.
You could just, if you didn't want it, me, you could just say,
I'd rather.
I'd rather just have a parking plan proposal. And they can look at that and they can put that in if they want. But why, you know, because then if we don't like it, we can't say,
right.
oh, no. It's like, oh, it's right here in the car.
So we're saying we do want to have a parking proposal.
Yeah. Okay.
Is everyone nodding yes? Not asleep. Everyone nodding yes.
Yep.
Yeah, I'll just make an observation. I think you need to look at your phases of when you're going to make decisions.
Mm-hmm.
Numbers of parking and the how you're going to park a place is kind of dealt with at one stage.
Mm-hmm.
Actual site plan or and design of the building is at another. So you can't do it all at once. You have to separate them out. So sometimes you don't want to conflate them into one particular mm-hmm. approval. You don't want to tie
yeah.
your hands later on these details around, you know, whether or not you break the whole front or how you twist it around until you're actually at the site level. But you need to know early on, what are my parking standards? That determines footprint size, layout, circulation, and things like that. So you have to kind of separate the two out so that they can only build to a certain amount. Then they know who they can market to, et cetera. So there's different phases
yeah.
of these approvals along the way. So you just have to be kind of conscious of that.
Yeah.
Kind of similar to the prelim in a site.
Exactly.
Prelim, you're just approving the number of units. They're just
right.
boxes.
Right.
You get to site, then all of a sudden now you're doing facades and so forth.
Right.
Maybe at prelim you're saying, here's our parking proposal. We're going to have a garage and then have a total number between the three different lots of 700 spots. And then at that time of site plan, okay, well, these will be in a structured parking with lattice
mm-hmm.
and this,
right.
this one will be over here,
mm-hmm.
this one will be over there. So you try to get a little shot.
Heather, that makes sense that you're talking about the phases.
Mm-hmm.
Is there any way you can
kind
of design it, mainly design the set to this phase component?
The parking proposal, and it may just be the, you know, the regulatory aspect that been so used to for almost two decades. I feel like we should give them a baseline.
Yep.
Okay.
Because, you know, we were sitting here last month, 2 months ago, saying, okay, we kind of want to know what you want. So if we, flexibility, we're all about it, but if we come to you and we show you a plan that's X amount of residential units and X amount of square feet commercial, and here's the parking, and you go, we don't like it, we just wasted our time.
Well, yeah.
So there sort of has to be, we got to get back to some guidelines. Flexibility is good, but
no,
as I said,
here.
Just referring to the current just goes back to the old way, like
right.
You said.
Exactly. Right, and I don't want to just, you know, I'm not saying that, and I agree with the parking, because I think that we have to have some sort of basis to...
Well, a good example, just a small example of going beyond what Barney was saying, but I think where he was going is next door, the two buildings next door have very limited parking, okay? There's residential apartments down here, okay? Those residential people park in those other spaces between the municipal lot, the lot on the corner, and behind 114, and by the time the business is open, most of those people are gone. So that residential component is going to be very different in a project like this as opposed to a standalone townhome community, condo community,
yeah.
or shopping center for that matter. So that shared use, as Victor was
which
saying, is even more
idea.
Shared,
right.
for lack of a better explanation, in these types of projects. So again, that same, that baseline is still a little heavy, and maybe it's not 100%, but there's definitely, there's not the need for as many residual. So if you say, for example, you start talking about condos and apartments, and you start saying, well, you know, what about the guests? Well, we have all this surface parking, you know, so do we really need to be thinking like a standalone apartment condo project or a standalone townhome project mm-hmm. that has all this overflow parking for the guests and the visitors, you know, the parties and all that stuff. So that's where you can really take that shared approach even further in mixed use communities.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Barney.
So Lindy?
Yeah.
So would it make sense, kind of what Rob was saying, give them some kind of guideline, is we would have our prescriptive as we have now, but their plan should show us why that should be relaxed, because there's so much
changes made to it.
Yeah, okay.
But in other words, that plan should be, you know, tell us, you know,
right.
what the formulas are that they're using. That
but make their proposal and include a rationale. Right.
But at the same time, we still maintain our prescriptive.
Right, so you're saying adhere to the standards in 112-7A, which is the size of the lot
right.
or the size of the parking space, and B, the space is required.
Right.
So that kind of, that's your standard, that kind of stays in there.
Until they prove
whether it's three lots of 25 parking spaces or one lot with 75 or 100 parking spaces.
Provided that the code already allows, as Tom was saying, for that to be incorporated in site plan approval and
right.
not a separate variance process.
Right.
But
okay.
if they are waiving something that's in, do they have to meet that hardship standard? Because if they do, then you can't, because they're creating their own hardship
right.
by the size of the
right.
development, and so we.
If that's the case,
would
we just put minimal standards?
I would recommend that. I mean, I would recommend you require them to do meet the minimum, and if they want, then you want to incentivize them and say, if you don't want to meet the minimum requirements we have, you give us a proposal of what you think is, and then you be able to prove it to you, and then you approve that revised standard. And so that you have the minimum, you know what the rules are coming in,
mm-hmm.
and if they want to be incentivized, and they say, you know, my project is less, I want to prove it to them, and then they can come in with a proposal that's different than that. It's kind of
yeah.
simple, but you don't require variance or approving of hardship
right.
for it. It's in,
right.
they're incentivized to do that.
Mm-hmm.
In the townhouse regulations, such as they are today, we do have a variation to the requirements for those types of projects in terms of subdivision plan. And it set forth a standard that is less than hardship. I forget what it is, but it's got some jingle, you know, reasonable, whatever, something. So you know, you're probably talking about adopting something more along those lines than imposing the hardship standard, because that would be impossible. That, well, it might not
be. We don't want to do that.
Self-create hardship, so it's not that.
Yes.
Yeah, the hardship standard is intended to address something that's completely
different. Right,
yeah. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. We don't want to do that.
Yeah,
we don't
want to do that. Imposed by the...
Again, I would encourage you to be... you've got professionals here along the way. You don't want to make it too burdensome at the front end, or else a developer will say, screw it, I'm just going to put the gazillions of parking spaces and you're going to regret it later on when they really want to create a walkable environment.
So, I think we're all like working towards the same
thing. Yeah.
I just don't know that baseline.
Yeah.
You know, and then...
Well, you have a baseline. You have your already regulations in place.
Right. Now, Leslie said you just wanted a parking proposal. You didn't.
Well, I don't like the status quo because
if they can't
show why it should be the status quo, we have all this parking that we don't need.
Right.
Right. Well, there's an incentive for them to cut down on spaces and put buildings in. So there's usually a market incentive and not having to meet, particularly if your standards are old standards.
Yeah, which I believe
a huge number of spaces that, this day and age, you're seeing old shopping centers put in.
They don't make it. They don't do it like that anyway.
Because they don't use it as parking.
Right.
Correct.
The only concern I would have in that format, I like Barney, he's a good guy, but he's going to have some standard to look at a waived standard. He has a baseline, and he's worked on that many times. We're all going to be doing, whoever comes in with the MXD project is going to be doing it for a first time. And I don't want to say, Barney, this is a really good parking plan. He's going to have nothing to reference it from. I would just say, to go back again, maybe we do ask or look at either other pattern books or other jurisdictions to see if they've looked at it and codified it or made a policy out of it, to say, here's the language that might work for us, just to have a baseline standard so it's not just us all guessing.
Guessing is inconsistent and unpredictable, and Barney and I aren't always going to be here, and I want there to be consistency and predictability.
Again, I would assume that you're going to require them to demonstrate other places that are built that you can actually go to and see and find out this is what the standard was in Germantown or wherever it is, so that you have that information. And professional engineers know how to do this stuff for you. And if they're motivated by reducing parking and putting more square footage in leasable space, they'll do it for you.
But I think the town, in all due respect to the town, I think that's the position they've been finding themselves all along, is they want a standard that they can enforce. That's been kind of a tough nut to crack in this whole ordinance.
Yeah, everybody tells us that they don't need as much parking as we say
But again, my point is that you're approving an MXD area. You're going to stipulate how many parking spaces per square footage, whatever. That's the enforceable component of this thing. Then you don't give them a building permit, or you don't give them a CO until they actually have that this parking in a phased manner. And I absolutely agree with this. You got to kind of recognize that you're not going to build all the parking at once. You're going to want to phase it in, and so your phase plan needs to have the right amount of parking, right amount of amenities for the development along the way. The phasing plan is probably one of the most important components of this process.
And parking is just one component.
Absolutely.
Okay, so now what did we... Now, Lindy, were you saying to incorporate Mr. McCullough's comments into, that they would be applicable to a phasing, like different phases, or?
Well, I like the idea of, this whole thing is all like a phase kind of, this process. So, I like that idea of somehow we set this ordinance up in that phase process where it would make more sense. I mean, we don't talk about parking when they first walk in the door. We talk about parking when they bring in a site plan or something, that's just what I was thinking. But I don't want to throw you off right now. But now, how are we going to do this? We're going to have add a parking standard, and then have them explain why they propose something different. I don't want to put them on the defensive that they have to come with our parking standard, but then give them the opportunity to say, well, I've got a better idea.
Right.
Well, you know, the thing is, the idea could be, I'm right next to the rails and trails, and, you know, people can walk downtown, or they can walk to certain places, or I'm going to contribute to something that helps people get across Route 70, I mean, Route 27, you know, safely, or, you know, it doesn't have to be, oh, I can just make less parking and build more buildings. I mean, there's creative things that can be done. If you are going to add some value that's not another parking space.
Mm-hmm. So that's for the number, like the number of parking spaces, but about the design requirements. So do we want to add those as, a mandate, or do we want to put them as general guidelines?
I think guidelines, but I don't think
yeah, that's a mandate.
All right, okay. So incorporating these as general, general guidelines.
Are we incorporating these?
No, we haven't.
What are we incorporating in guidelines?
Good question.
I'm speaking to Mr. McCullough's two.
Here to the standards prescribed
parking
in 112-79.
One and two. I need guidance as to the disposition of that.
I'm sorry. So you're using his.
What are you? Are you using the? You're going to put number two structure parking in there?
I'm looking for guidance from the planning commission as to how to incorporate.
If we're talking about phases, why couldn't we say up front that there is a proposal or there's a sharing with us? Whether it's going to be a traditional parking approach or it's going to be an alternative approach, you know, they're going to have a sense of what they think will be a better fit with the design of the building and the layouts.
And it is at the beginning because the design comes from they're intertwined. You know, it's at the beginning. So if there's an expectation by the town that it's going to be, you know, for mixed use, the commercial uses is 5 per 1,000. That's going to dictate how many square feet and how many parking spaces,
right.
Which
mm-hmm.
then translates to Ron putting it on a plan.
Right.
And then same thing with residential. If a flat or efficiencies one space and two bedrooms two spaces and three bedrooms two and a half spaces, whatever it is, those basic standards should be outlined. So that's the basic standard, but then we say, okay, we're next to rails to trails. Or we have X amount of resident or commercial flat parking that's not going to get used that the spillover can go there. Then you start to make that flexibility.
Mm-hmm.
But I think we as professionals need to have a baseline that's going to create the plan. I mean, it really is. And maybe that baseline is more flexible than what you have today as far as your standard, knowing it's MXP.
So
maybe it's not. Maybe it's not 5 per 1,000.
Mm-hmm.
You know, maybe it's something different that comes from other MXD type products. But I think we want that so that we don't come in, spend a bunch of money with the engineer, and then you go, we want more parking.
Okay.
Because when you say more parking, that basically wipes out buildings, moves roads, things like that.
Yeah.
And that's expensive.
Well, and it can also, if we don't have a proven standard, then we're just going off of what we, our perception. Well, that's not going to be enough parking.
Okay, so we agreed we're going to have some sort of baseline parking standard and the flexibility also coming back with a proposal about what I have a better idea.
Again, that baseline may already anticipate something different than you have based on you do a little bit of research and see what you
know. Yeah, right.
Yeah. So but that's kind of like parked over there.
So I'm not trying to be.
It's okay. Just
have we answered the question as to what we're doing with the proposed or the suggested parking design standards?
No, I think that's really.
I just want to make sure that I have.
No, we were saying we need a baseline parking. We still don't know what it is.
Okay, baseline parking. I'm going to research that, and that's for the quantitative element. For parking.
Mm-hmm.
So now let's speak to, if we can, the proposed, the where the parking should be, as suggested.
Right.
What does the planning commission wish to do with those suggestions?
I think you have to be very flexible in that area because
you can't say where.
You can't say where now because you're going to develop,
seven and a half acres
of property.
Way back in the beginning when, well, your beginning was way before my beginning, but, you know, still that was at least 2 years ago. So even in a development where, let's say it's mostly commercial or whatever, I don't think we're looking for big, you know, Walmart-type parking lots, are we? I mean, people are still envisioning in developers?
No. Or? I think, again, the idea driving towards the whole design, putting the buildings up front, already
Good. You're still thinking of that.
Well,
okay.
Of course. I think
well, I was going to say, when I was looking at some of the emails that you'd sent from the Kaz brothers, from Victor, so a couple of them were good, but then there was the one that you called the town center, which to me looked like outlet mall, you know, with a few plants.
I'm talking about the pictures.
The pictures.
Some of the pictures in the rear.
Yeah, some of the pictures weren't to say this is, it's really, some of the questions were
just
related to height.
More about the height. So, I got that part, but that one picture that was, entitled Town Center, and it basically was a big parking lot with some small shops on the sides. Okay, so we're still looking at, Rob, we're still have the same idea as before for the most part. Okay.
Okay, so the where is we don't know. So we're not going to have to find the where.
But are we going to, I'm going to play devil's advocate here.
Go for it.
Are we going to say that all the parking has to be in the back? Because there is a street design part that there will be some parking on the street. Okay.
I can't say that either.
I think the parking is going to be very flexible depending on what you're building there. You might be building three buildings that it would be beneficial to have each have their own parking, or you might be building three buildings that would be beneficial for them to share a lot. You know, 100 parking spaces in a lot or whatever.
Or it might be a garage.
Instead of three lots of, you know, 35 spaces
each.
Might
be a garage.
So back to Bill's comment on structured parking. I noticed later in the ordinance there's a section about the height of the buildings. Will that be adjusted if there is structured parking? Because it's kind of, I don't feel that it's very, that it's going to help move along the parking, or if it's only a two-story parking structure.
We'll get to that.
And do you mind introducing yourself?
I'm Sean Gratton, new member of the Economic Development.
Oh, okay.
He's new EDC member.
Okay, welcome.
We'll have to discuss it. We'll get to the height stuff.
Yeah, I don't think we're going to finish all this.
Regarding the placement of parking, I know you're having some design guidelines at one point. You may want to just play out some what you'd like them to see, because you're absolutely right. Each site's different. Depending upon the road that's in front of, the speed, orientation of building, or orientation of lots, it's just impossible for you to say you have to have it at the back. There's just too many parameters for you to, but you can lay out in a design, and usually you can, quite frankly, reference some of the APA or other types of engineering examples of these things. I think you get a sense from the intent here what you're trying to have when you look at these things. And you allow for, what you're looking at, and then they start to send something that's clearly off base, you'll be able to push back at that point.
Well, and you also have situations where you have three buildings, and they have 35 spaces each, and somebody parks up here and then walks all the way down through, and then they're parked at a smaller lot. You know, at that point, it might be beneficial to have a larger lot that all three buildings share.
That goes back to operational.
Right. So it all depends on what you're building, what the design is.
Okay. All right. So we're going to create baseline parking standards for numbers, and the design, and the other will be part of an initial design guideline.
Okay. And also we're offering that they also could submit a parking proposal that's different from our baseline standards.
Yes.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay. So we have homework.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So next on the bottom of page 7, Victor's comment, same comment regarding the inclusion of the term industrial. We already killed that one.
Well, we put it in the parking lot.
Yeah, we put it in the second. It's parked in the parking lot again. Yeah.
But there was another one here. Under 112.37.2.
Is that Melissa or Bill?
That's Bill.
And
it says within the Mount Airy town limits.
It's the same thing.
Okay.
Just
carry
it over
into
section.
Oh, okay.
I
think it will within town limits.
Yep.
Okay.
Page 8. Okay, there's nothing I see on 8.
There's over here.
Okay.
C.
Oh, okay.
Section C2.
Oh, yeah.
Hey, Melissa Beth.
So we had him to a maximum of 15,000 square feet, and he's got to say 55,000 square feet, and then that's what Bill had. Yeah, Melissa and Bill both had it. Okay.
What page are you on now?
Well, we're on, now we'll go back, we're on 8 of 17, C, permitted uses, the last sentence, about the 15,000 square feet. And then we have Melissa and Bill's comments, both on that one, talking about them proposing 65,000 square feet. And we did a lot about this one.
I said that I was supportive of what was written in the document.
Oh.
Not long and lengthy.
I
really liked your comment. That was,
I thought,
really,
well, I did a little research of just trying to figure out what different companies are doing.
Yeah, I thought that was really good.
Okay. Actually kind of drew from what our residents were calling in and we wanted
what they're asking for, So have you looked at the comment that Melissa?
Yeah,
the different stores that are actually interested in being smaller. And it might actually,
yep.
What do you guys think? This is a huge.
So this is obviously the meat of our plans, our thoughts, our concerns. It's multi-pronged. Number one, and he says this to me all the time in the office, my brother, so that's why I have. Number one is market is the market is, right? We're not going to dictate if Mount Airy deserves a 59,000 square foot grocery, you know, high-end grocery store because that's what the market is, I'm not going to tell them they can only build 57. They're going to tell me what they want to build, and we're going to see if we can design it so that the planning commission wants it in here. So the market is going to determine a lot of what can come here. So to say that there are smaller versions of stores does not mean that they would come here. They may be able to build a 22,000 square foot Target. Target may say, I will never build that product here. That's not going to make me any money in this market when I need a 60,000 or I need something in economies of scale to work. That's one thing. So the market determines a lot. But the second part is the issue, you know, the concept that we're going to go through a very lengthy concept plan, preliminary plan, detailed design plan, and also a special exception for uses that are 100% going to be included in a town center of size, not every single property, but in a town center of size, perhaps, you know, the ones that we're working on, is very problematic. To think that there's another process, a ZHE, someone else who's going to determine whether or not that use is acceptable or not. So we could be, for example, in a concept plan, doing a design and spending, you know, a couple hundred thousand dollars on plans and have a use going maybe in a parallel track. It doesn't say whether they're parallel or you have to stop one to start the other. And maybe in a parallel track get declined so that whatever design we put in front of the planning commission is not valid because it wasn't valid, one of the uses wasn't valid in front of a different group. I think we should all expect that at least on some projects, they're going to be larger than 15,000. To require a special exception to get that approval, I don't think is necessary in the context of what you guys have all said tonight. Number one, you guys are going to decide design, whether you like it or not, whether it fits in with character and all of the things. Giving you the discretion to say that it's acceptable to the town,
But to limit it before it even gets to the planning commission or to other people, I think is going to be problematic. I mean, there was a good comment before from multiple people. Town center, one of the concepts of town centers is that people are going to come from other places to come here. People will not come here for 7,000 and 8,000 square foot stores. There are already those stores here. They're not going to come here for that. I don't drive to Columbia from Almy for a 7,000 square foot. I go to Wegmans, because I don't have a Wegmans, and I go to other stores of size, but I don't need to go somewhere else and get the same exact uses I'm getting in my town. So I think we have to anticipate that there are going to or needs to be other types of uses not existing or complementary that are of size to take advantage of its location in the town center on Route 27, directly off Route 7. And to add restrictions to that size or to add the special exception process, I think is a mistake.
The only thing I would comment on that is, isn't this similar to where we ended up with drive-thrus, where yes. It was redundant? So the town already has an upper limit restriction.
65,000.
That's already in the zoning ordinance. So now we've added another layer here, and I don't really have a dog in this fight, but it seems to me it's the same rationale as the drive-thru, meaning that you all are the ones that are going to look at it, make a recommendation. It's going to go out for public notice, which has already been, because there's public notice built into this process. And now it's going to go to another board for approval, and then come back to you. So again, it's the same process as we talked about for drive-thrus. So I'm not so sure. I think his comments are valid as it pertains to the process.
We have the 15,000 square feet, as I remember, and correct me if I don't remember this correctly, was because we were concerned about businesses being drawn from the town. Or wasn't that it? We were concerned about the town businesses, some businesses that we didn't want some huge thing, or our local business competing against that. That's what I remember this as.
There was a discussion that we didn't want competition between our downtown, mm-hmm. but the reverse would, if we make it too boutique-y, But if we are thinking that we're going to have boutique stores in these MXD zones, yeah. it will directly compete with mm-hmm. our downtown. So there's a balance. Way back when we started, I think we were approaching this MXD as sort of an incremental type of development. So our downtown, our sizes are limited to 15,000 square feet. And then so we thought of the MXD zone when we started this journey a couple years ago as, okay, well, you know, we're envisioning that 15,000 to 65,000, you know, in a special exception realm. I don't know if that's still applicable after we...
Again, taking that 10,000 foot approach.
Right.
You all are going to see which property, there's only a handful. You guys are going to be able to see which property you're going to want that special exception approved and which ones you're not. There's only a handful that could even go to that scale, okay, of development. Mm-hmm. So,
we have
again,
two conversations, though.
Well,
one is there. Do we require it? You know, if we're going to make it a special exception, or are we putting different develop? Are we thinking that it doesn't need any special exception, and then up to 65,000 would be a use permit by right? Or would there be, you know, additional considerations by the planning commission if it were to break that 15,000 square foot threshold?
15,000 square feet is not a whole lot of square footage.
But the whole MXD is the additional consideration, right?
Right.
It is design driven. And the first conversation you and I had, you said, don't come in and create something that cannibalizes downtown. And I think that's a great, you know, starting process.
Yep.
It's going to be different, but there are already design standards built in that are an additional step that aren't you know, standalone project.
I think the concern is that we, from the Planning Commission, is the big box all we're going to get.
Fair enough.
Then, Sean, you're after Roxanne. Roxanne, you go next.
I think we have to look at this, too, in knowing that some of these stores, people are driving up and down 70, and they don't live here in Mount Airy. But let's say they're driving home and they need something, and they can, the town centers or whatever, they can go in. And we do not want to restrict any type of economic or monetary thing that's going to help the town of Mount Airy. And by having some of these larger stores, and they're not, I wouldn't come into Mount Airy for something, you know, like that's here, I'd make that a day trip or something, okay? But if I'm on my way home and there's something of a, whatever, I'm not gonna make any names, but something where I can stop, a dry cleaner or whatever, on my way home, and it's in Mount Airy, then the business person is gonna benefit and the town of Mount Airy is gonna benefit. And I think we don't wanna restrict it too much, because then the businessman's gonna say, well, I can't, you know, I'm not coming here, and then the developer has trouble filling what he's got. We can't, and we're sitting there with vacant buildings. We don't want that.
Okay. Sean, you want to add?
Can you just put an analogy to it? What's the idea behind shopping malls originally? It was that there's a anchor store, which is a large department store, and all the smaller stores inside the mall flourish because people go to those department stores and they wander throughout the mall. Mm-hmm. So why wouldn't we want to allow the 6,000 square feet for a large store that's going to bring people here and allow the other stores and shops to flourish? I don't think that we can say necessarily that it's going to deter small business in the town. I'd like to think that it would help small business in the town.
Okay, did you finish, Mike? You're next.
When Walmart came to Mount Airy, everyone was freaking out that they were going to take business away from people. They didn't. They increased business in this town.
I did.
When you're talking about the corridor, which most of these properties emptied onto or affiliated, the corridor is driven by 20,000 plus people every day, mm-hmm. and I would say 80% of them don't live in Mount Airy. They're going from somewhere in Westminster, they're going to work.
At least half of them don't live here.
At least, if not more. It's we don't know through. Those statistics.
Yeah.
But when they come home, they don't want to go all the way back up to Taylorsville or Eldersburg. Mm-hmm. And they want to stop to pick something up on the way.
When they get on their home.
Okay. If you're going to be building small stores that compete with your little stores in the downtown district, but they're not going to stop there. It never gets them acquainted with our town. And it doesn't fulfill their needs. 27 is not going to decrease in traffic because we will it. It's never going to decrease in traffic. And we don't own the traffic. It's not us that puts the traffic out there. Why not exploit it with things that people want in our own town?
Easy in, easy out.
And where can I get a sandwich?
Right.
Big box stores have been demonized in this town for too long. It's time that you guys start waking up to that.
Well, when you go down in all those stores that are down around Walmart now, they're all busy every day.
Because Walmart drew them there.
Right, exactly.
Chuck, you're next.
I go there for the grocery store.
Then I get I'll get your an enforcement issue. Someone builds this, and again, one, imagine you know, 15,000 square foot next to 15,000 square foot, both go vacant. Someone comes in and they want to do, you're going to say, no, you can't combine the two.
You buy both of them and knock the
so,
wall down.
Again, you want to be mindful of not creating an enforcement or a nightmare later on. I think to some degree, some of this is a walkability issue. If you're trying to create a walkable environment, what Walmarts tend to do, or Targets, and you have this huge blank wall that's cold and doesn't have any interest to it. If you design it where it's active fronts for that achieve that 15,000, but they're three of them, and they got 45,000 square feet for one of them, but they have multiple entrances. What's the problem? You've achieved your now you may be cheap, maybe you're competing against the downtown. That's a separate challenge. I don't dispute that. But you have to, again, what's the zoning ordinance for? What are other economic development strategy for? If you're trying to deal with use and look,
That's one thing. So again, try to not conflate this. You're not going to solve all your problems with this one ordinance.
Right.
Okay.
Exploitation.
There's a point also that I can understand the interest in protecting the existing downtown businesses. At the risk of sounding like the skunk of the garden party, there is a certain level at which police power justification for economic competition disappears. The other thing that I'd like to pick up on is kind of a metaphor that was suggested by Tom earlier. If I'm reading this correctly, we're now in the zoning ordinance portion of the proposal. And we're talking about what sounds essentially like design or someone said operational sorts of circumstances. I'm not certain that this kind of distinction that's being drawn based on the square footage of a store may be appropriate in a zoning ordinance element of your overall package. Now, if we get back to what it is that this the mixed-use district is supposed to represent, again, we've talked about flexibility. But it's design-driven. It's something that someone is going to bring to you to determine whether or not this proposal works at this location in this community. And a lot of those concerns may, because we don't know who's going to bring it, which property it is necessarily, and what the components of it are going to be, to try to sit here and think now about, I don't want to create a one-size-fits-all solution to everything that may happen in the future. Maybe somewhat self-delusional. So if some of these details, as has been suggested, can be left to what these mixed-use, these kinds of programs are about, it's to be, you want to try and leave some of this for the design submission phase of this to see if the design, based on certain guidelines or standards, actually comports with the purpose of what you're trying to do.
So is the consensus?
I have a comment. So, Heather. She's my go-to. So I wouldn't necessarily have a problem with going to the 65,000 square feet. However, the back in our 85%, 15%. So I would not want the one business to be able to be 85%. So I think that if we want to go to 65,000 square feet, there's got to be something in the other part of that the ordinance where that's not going to take up. That's not going to be the one business component of that development. So it would just be one big box.
Rob,
we're going to I agree with that too. You want to fill in with a whole bunch of little stores.
I don't do big box, I'm with the
You want to fill in with the candle store and the unique clothing and that kind of stuff.
I don't think there's a problem with that concept. I agree. Because, from our perspective, we want to have multiple of everything. So I don't think as a standard to say, your 15% can't be this, or your 85 right. can't be this one use, right. since you're trying to make mixed use, the centerpiece of this downtown. I don't think that's a problem for standard. Just figure out, we just have to figure out what kind of language work for, but I think that's a good
okay. Then I'm good with it.
Okay. All right, so we would essentially accept Mr. McCullough's suggestion to just mirror the CC mm-hmm. of the 65,000 square feet.
Yes.
Without a special
section.
And that's from zero to, zero to 65,000, right?
Yes, zero to 65,000.
You guys could ask a question about appropriate size.
Right.
Yeah. Right. Okay.
We might not ever see it. We might not ever see that 65,000.
So you're saying 165 is not a good ceiling.
That's
a special.
Anything over 65,000 would be
a special exception.
Currently in our code.
Yep.
And that mirrors what is existing in the community commercial district.
Mm-hmm. Over 65 is
a special exception.
Special exception.
Yes.
Yep. Okay.
Like their eyes
look,
are
I see that.
What happens is it goes back to the mechanics again, meaning at what point will we know that it's acceptable? So up there's a picture of the Rio.
I can't see it, but.
But if you looked at your email, you would have pulled it up. Yeah,
sure. So
no, I haven't.
Right here's a picture of the Rio.
That's the one that.
This is a target right here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah, that looks pretty good.
What's the approximate size of that, Craig?
Most targets, I have to look up this one. This one's a pretty big one, but most targets are around 80,000.
Yeah. Okay.
So this target is two levels.
Right.
So it's not that sprawl of a Walmart, where a Walmart is 160 and it just goes on forever and it's a football field.
What if it's gross, just like...
Why do we say, if we say gross?
Well, what I mean is it's two levels, and within the rest of this town center, it does not stick out
right.
as a big box.
Yeah.
But it is the draw. So you have people coming downtown, I'm going to hit Target, then I'm going to hit the beer and wine, I'm going to hit the spa, I'm going to hit the Barnes and Nobles, all of those things. As you said, in a day trip. So one of the factors to think about is Mount Airy is a new frontier for a lot of retailers. And we need, these draws are not only for bringing in people and keeping the residents shopping here instead of going on day trips other places, but those draws are also for the commercial. There's going to be a lot of commercial players who say, I'm not taking the chance of going to an area and opening up a brand new 70,000 square foot spot. If someone does, a big guy like Target says, I'll do the two level and fit it into the town center, not only does it draw people, but it draws you that Barnes and Nobles. It draws you the other, it draws that Trader Joe's and all these things, or maybe even a boutique, you know, movie theater, the things that you really want follow something big and something popular. So that draw is not just for people, it's for the businesses. And what I'm getting at is, if someone says, I would do a two level, it's 72,000. Okay, we're a little bit above 65. What is the mechanism? It's a special exception. And back to what my brother was saying earlier, which is, if I go through $400,000 worth of engineering and planning, and here's a 72,000 square foot piece in the middle of it, and all of a sudden we're all thinking it looks pretty good, but the ZHE says no. A year into it, how do I work my planning around that? I didn't know if because this MXD has so many steps, we have a concept, we have a prelim, we have a site, and then permits. Can the board have the wherewithal to make, can they approve over 65 where they see that there, it is merit-based? If there is something that comes in that is, yes, that is what we want in the town because they're coming in here and bringing two other retailers with them that we really want, to sidetrack everyone on a special exception that's really not in the board's hands, and also puts me in a position where am I spending more money while I wait to do this and designing more, and then get shut down, and then I go back to Target and say, you gotta make it 65, and they're like, I wanna be 80, now I gotta be 65. Well, we're not gonna do it, and then I lose them and I lose these two. You have a lot of steps in this MXD. Is there a way to give you the power to look at going above that 65 early, later, whatever it is, and give you some kind of, if there's a justification statement or so to that effect?
Well, can I just respond to something?
Microphone.
Sure. I would think,
yeah, we can't hardly hear you, Pat.
Oh, I'm sorry. Okay. I was just talking to him, sorry. I would think that before you would start, I mean, at this point, you know a general idea of what you want to do. Okay, you have some ideas.
Sure.
you might have some retailers coming to you, or you might have some, but that you're talking to some of those retailers. I would think at the beginning, you would know who one of those stores are going to be,
the anchor.
Anchor.
The links, yeah, the anchor store. Okay. So they would give you an idea of how much would work for them. So knowing that we would prefer not to be more than 65,000 square feet, but we're willing to grant a special exception if it makes sense to bring other smaller retailers to that area, that you would be able to come to us in the beginning and say, you know, Target may be on board, but look in about 72,000, so that we could work with that from the beginning.
And that's what he's trying to say. Instead of us going to a different body for that approval, the special exception is not heard by the planning commission. What he's saying is, okay, let's just use 65,000. If 65,000 is permitted, and give the board discretion over the board, not someone else.
Right, not
give,
zoning
give the board discretion, basically the power to grant a special exception under some other name, but the board can look at 65 and over and say, yes, we like it only because it fits these, you know, there's some criteria for it. It's bigger than our thing, but we like it because it works for the things that we're doing. By having a special exception, it's a complete,
we have a former Board of Zoning Appeals chairperson sitting right here.
The Board of Appeals acts on the recommendation of the staff and the recommendation of the planning and zoning. So if you came right away and said that there's, and you could even say there's the possibility that we're going to hear what you're going to say, and we're going to recommend it to the Board of Appeals. The staff then gives them their recommendation. I can't speak for the Board of Appeals as it is now, but generally the feeling is if the staff recommends approval, the Board of Appeals generally approves that. And it can be done like Patty says, right at the beginning.
Mike and then Chuck.
So I think this goes back to some of the experiences that this town has suffered with James Way, Ames, Superfresh. There are no provisions for bankruptcies and empty stores. We find that not appealing in our town. I don't know what a solution to something. You bond that where it needs to be torn down or something. And I think for the Planning Commission to unilaterally make a decision on such a size of store puts an undue burden on them. And I think they'd want more support.
It's already in the code. It's already in the code. The commercial code is 65,000.
They're trying to circumvent it.
No, I know, but you're saying that we're putting a burden, and what I'm saying is it's already in the town code that council passed, not us. Yeah. That's what I'm saying.
No, I understand that, but I agree with the code as it's written, because I think that adds a little bit more assurance for your decisions and for the future. I think it can be done expeditiously.
Yeah.
But my concerns on all these large stores are vacancies, and we've seen it. And it scares our town for a number of reasons. Security, empty stores, you know.
We got that whole Carroll Medical Center where Superfresh used to be.
Yeah, but how many years?
Look how long it took.
8 years to get there.
Let's get those.
Heather says five.
Chuck, you know, my job here is to provide you guidance on just the, first of all, what is the purpose of this requirement for 65,000 square feet? If you're going to just deal with a single story, you could, and again, if your purpose is just to deal with the facade, walkability, all that, or maybe it is an overall massing issue, you could just deal with, rather than total square footage, you could be the footprint, which allows for, again, an incentive for them to go up
and within that. That's one thing. Again, all of this is assumed that it's going to be approved by your town council and it goes into law. And secondly, with regard to special exceptions, I caution you to have specific standards by which the Board of Zoning Appeals reviews and approves anything. So you're going to have specifics of why you're going to go above 65,000 square feet, not because they like it or because they like the pictures. You're going to have real specific standards that because ultimately, if they meet the standards, that Board of Zoning Appeals is supposed to approve it. Now, they don't. They're going to be in trouble when it gets challenged if they don't have a reason for it. So it's got to have specific standards. Otherwise, my experience has been the discretion is better handled by a planning commission and possibly even to a conditional use by the town councils. Only when you want to allow for that, I hate to say, politicizing a particular development approval. But don't put the Board of Zoning Appeals in that they want to be able, what the criteria are, to meet it or not, and not be into that kind of situation.
Right.
I have a question.
Yeah.
Okay, go ahead, quickly.
So does anyone know, or are you looking at Heather? Just for example, the Beck property on the, I guess that's the east side of 27, do we know what the square footage of that is compared to the Rio or any of these?
The acreage?
Yeah.
So the R7 portion, I believe, is about 30 acres. I do not have the...
10,
so ours is 30 acres.
Around
11?
Towns, the west side, the town center side, the smaller side, I think that is 30 and
you know what I have the master plan, right?
30 and 50.
What's the Rio?
So, yeah, do you have those
acres? I don't know the square footage of the Rio. The Ketlands is massive.
Yeah,
it's not even comparable. Rio
town center's not.
Rio is pretty big.
Yeah, Rio's big.
They have no structured parking in Ketlands. It is all surface parking.
Yes, it is.
Massive.
Yep.
So
yes,
the Rio is an interesting comparison, but they also have three structured parking, which is really expensive. Mm-hmm. Because they're commanding rents. They have three big boxes. They have Target, Kohl's, and Galleons.
Dicks.
Dicks. And older guy. Barnes and Noble. So they're commanding higher rents. And then they have all the way across the bridge, that whole section across the bridge. So they were able to go vertical with all their parking. So it's a smaller footprint, but the Beck property is going to have issues in rent versus structure and surface parking and also topography.
Right.
That is where things are going to get interesting. And
oh, you're talking about the east side.
West
is a lot smaller.
West side is going to be that's got the most topography and that's going to be the harder.
Well, it's got the hill.
The west side is the west really smaller?
What did you say, 30 acres on the west, 50 on the east?
Roughly, yeah.
Ballpark.
West side, the smaller side is on the town center side.
Right. Yes. Between here and Watkins. Between here and Watkins.
Right.
Okay, so.
So the west side connects to Center Street.
Right.
The west side is what's going to be downtown.
Yeah.
And I think to go to your point, you already have a town code that says if you want to go over 65, you go to special exception. And you're creating an MXD zone. If you want to say, if you are in an MXD and you want to go 65, you go through this process, as opposed to using the town code to go special exception. If you're an MXD, we want you to go to, is it a special meeting? Is it a statement of justification that's viewed by all of those? You have a chance to streamline the process, and if you want other agencies involved, you can put them involved, but you might be able to streamline it as opposed to submit the special exception, go to this board, this appeals, and then come back. If it's vertically integrated into the MXD process, then it will hold different plans. And my concern is, with a lot of retailers, it's a lot of who's coming to the party. There's not a lot of I'm the first one there. Target's in. You know, a lot of it is Target wants to see the concept. Mm-hmm. What's the concept? How many rooftops do you have approved around here?
Yeah.
Okay, well, I'm thinking about it, and then I'm talking to three other guys. What we're thinking about is Target going on. You know, it is that, mm-hmm. and I might be way into the concept trying to tell Target, mm-hmm. yeah, they approved 50,000 houses, you can put a Target there. And at that point, I'm way into it. And when I come back with that, hey, can we put a 70,000 square foot building, I don't want to go back around to get here. I'm just saying, in MXD, we can create a condition to, and you can create who you want to approve it in there. Just mm-hmm. it just streamlines the process.
So we have Leslie, and then we have Roxanne.
So I am, I'll say the other thing. So I think, I definitely understand what you're saying, no question. And I think that I was playing with some numbers, and I was saying, so if there was something like 10% or less, you know, that they wanted, that we could perhaps have a mechanism. What I would be concerned about is if everybody already knew that, then they would just say, all right, well, we're now at 72 automatically. And so I don't,
So the other thing to consider with this is, and we haven't gotten to the height discussion, but we require a minimum of 2 stories for our height. So are we worried about the collective square footage, or are we just worried about the massing of the, I am really sorry. My hands don't work this late at night. I apologize.
Throw it back.
So, Craig, what is 65,000 square foot footprint?
That's right.
Be more digestible.
That's too big.
But this is what we're talking about in CC.
But go back to what we said at the beginning. The market is the market.
Right.
So your concern that everybody's going to go to 72 is, I would say, invalid.
But
only
now,
someone may, but there are going to be a lot of people saying, I want to do the store that's this size because this is what the market bears. It's not like everybody's going to run in and go, ooh, we can, you know, everybody can put 120,000 square foot stores. It wouldn't be like that at all. I think also to your concern is when you get the preliminary plan, if there's one giant store and you say, there it is.
Yeah.
No. I mean, you are reviewing the preliminary plan and you can say, no, this is not the vision of mixed use town centers. I mean, the vision was to have multiple stores. So I think us circumventing percentages and saying how we followed code, it is so design driven. You can say no based on so many arguments. It doesn't. I don't think that's a way to go around. And also, we are trying to make a town center. You can't put these multifamilies and things and say there's one store under there.
Right. Right.
It goes.
I wasn't talking about the one store that time. It was really just 7,000 feet. That's all. That's the difference between 65 and
70. Well, such a minimal amount. Why worry about
such a minimal amount? So,
but
right. But we're creating a code. You're creating an MXD code, and you're just creating the mechanisms in the code that allow you to make approvals. So, what I'm saying is, if you're going to allow up to 65,000 feet, fine. If you say if it is above 65,000 square feet, we don't have to decide right now, but this is the mechanism you will use. You can say, yes, it has to be special exception, or you can say, in MXD itself, you can get approval for over 65 by following.
Or it has
you
to
can
be,
file
you
with
say it's got to be two-story anyway, right?
You're just creating a mechanism for that approval.
We require, our height requirement as proposed is
right.
that nothing can, it has to be a minimum of 2 stories.
Right.
Whether that's right. architecturally or it's 2 floors, the building itself has to be, as Craig pointed out, that it's a 2-story target.
That one is, you know, that particular example is a 2-story.
So is that 80,000 square feet gross floor? So there's 40 and 40?
I would assume, I've been in that one. That one's pretty much just a sandwich. It's 2 floors of 40-40.
Okay.
But in general, I don't want to get into the exact look and things of building. It's really about creating a mechanism for you to approve it within the same process that you are, because you're going to be so into this process from concept all the way through, you want everything in that MXD and the project in that flow and in your guidance at the end of the project. Taking the side steps out of the MXD process to go to CHEs or Board of Appeals and things, and coming back, I don't think is the purpose of the MXD.
Well, your design and your look are going to be different on this side of 27 than they are on the other side of 27.
Correct.
You know, so this is a zoning that allows you the flexibility to do all kinds of things.
Why don't we do a maximum of a 40,000 footprint?
Yeah. That'll be two stories.
And then you can go two stories, 40,000, 40,000, and you're.
That's what matters.
Going to flexibility. I don't want to create boxes here.
Right.
We're creating
right.
a code.
Oh, no.
So
okay.
what you're doing is
all right.
you have a maximum square footage that's allowable. If you want to go over that square footage, whatever form it takes, here is the mechanism to get our approval
yes.
to do
yes.
it.
So why couldn't we go ahead then and say leave it with the 65,000 square foot for the footprint?
Right.
Because market may demand it, may not. But anything above that is up to, let them come to, with the design of what they're going to put together. And then we can say, that one store is so massive compared to the other stores, that's not going to work. But we let them bring it to us, and we can set the limit of 65,000 as a footprint, because it's already in existence, and we'll just add that it's the footprint, not the total square footage of the store. And let them bring us the design, and we can say that is dominating. That is not the visual that we wanted for that type of thing. Let them design it. Let them figure out who's going to move into it.
You just have to put in language that right now your town code wouldn't allow you to say yes. I'm just saying put in language that allows you to say yes, you'd like what's above.
The ordinance.
I'm not talking about the ordinance. I'm talking about an act.
We've got two conversations. So let's finish that one. We start with yours with Tom, okay?
I understand.
But it allows you that flexibility.
But it's written right now. Can I get that approved?
Yeah, what we're saying is that's what I'm proposing.
Yes. Okay, so we got that. Now, Bob, you had a conversation with Tom.
Yeah, I was wondering if this stuff goes from planning to the town council, but in this case
no.
it does not.
No.
We'll approve the ordinance, okay, the MXD ordinance, but then, you know, the shopping centers and all that kind of stuff, buck stops right here.
Yes.
Yeah.
So if we're going to give you 130,000, you know, 65 and 65, and we're going to give Rob that, but we're not going to give your brother that for some particular reason.
I don't mind if he doesn't get it.
we're going to have to be able to justify that with some real reasoning and stuff.
There's one other point that we were concerned about, and we started with Center Street in particular because of proximity must be complementary to downtown, because we have basically a postage stamp downtown. Our best choice of expanding our downtown is to make that area complementary. Okay. The other concern we had was one of scale, because that particular area has residential all the way around it. So size and where those larger entities are located are going to be really, really important. Our concern, there's so many reasons why we want to do infill first, existing infrastructure and all of that. But it also says the complementariness of each of those designs and how it matches and fits in and works with what's already around it. That's going to be challenging, but very important to us.
And that's what the pattern book is going to do,
right.
Whether we're going to approve it or not.
Heather,
we approve this part or not.
Heather, you
I'm sorry,
that.
Heather.
I figured myself out.
Okay, Tom?
Just, and I'm not saying these are insurmountable, these are issues that need to be looked at. And
right, our minds here can probably maybe figure a way around this. But the two things that I think you do have to remember is that once you, as a zoning matter, define a use of right, your ability to design away, the ability to use, to partake in that use of right, some would argue becomes limited. Particularly where your considerations deal with things like impact, because there are arguments that, well, the town council in passing an ordinance that allows a particular use of right has already considered the adverse impacts, weighed the twos and the fros, the positives and the negatives, and determined that, you know, an impact is acceptable. And the second thing is that, you know, we do have to deal with the state code that defines what a Board of Appeals is, what its role is, what its powers are. And to the extent that you simply attempt to, in effect, transfer what is really a special exception process vested in the Board of Appeals to the Planning Commission, one, I could envision somebody arguing, well, that you can't do that. Mm-hmm. So again, I'm not saying these are insurmountable problems. I'm sure there are things that can be done, but I just do raise those two issues for consideration at this time.
Would there be any, and I'm going back to the drive-through conversation, are there any, not specific, but development standards that we could incorporate rather than just a variance or a special exception, but put them as development standards for those uses that are over the 65,000? Square feet. I don't know what those are right now.
I like that.
But criteria, if you will.
You have two lawyers' hands up. That's not good.
And this isn't well thought through, but I'm just.
Your attorney, I think, pointed out an important distinction here. The special exception is really for use issues. We're talking about massing, we're talking about square footage, the same use, potentially. So, again, I'm a Frederick City kind of guy. I rewrote Frederick City's ordinance. The Planning Commission there was given the ability to modify, quite frankly, in the mixed use, pretty much all the standards. It was a blanket provision. All the standards, if you want to modify them, you come to them, and then you make your case, and you talk about it. Flexible. But it's in the standards, it's not the use. So the deviation from the use absolutely should go to the Board of Zoning Appeals if you have a particular use. But don't conflate size, square footages, and the same use and say, well, it's 65,000 square feet, we're gonna move over, but it's the same use. And that's where I think is an important distinction too.
And our existing regulations for, Rob, thank you.
Thank
Sorry,
you. I have to get
over myself. No, have a good night. Thank
good
you
night.
So much.
Thank you for listening.
So, I mean, our special exception standards for the community commercial districts are not germane to what we're trying to achieve in MXD. So we would, it's not as simple as just saying, you know, that these standards will apply to the CC district in MXD. They require very specific setbacks, and they have to be set back from the road. So it really, it's counterproductive to the vision, if you will. So I just wanted to just food for thought that our existing standards, we, no matter what route we go, we have to come up with specific criteria to evaluate those uses over $65,000.
I have as much a question as anything else, initially. In your local code, many local ordinances, and you see this a lot with plan development, aspects of the code, you may have a parallel that you can borrow and use here that's already in existence. Sometimes there's a baseline threshold residential density for a particular type of residential product that then can be augmented or enhanced, however you want to describe it, by the Planning Commission as part of the review process to increase that residential density based on the developer or applicant meeting certain essentially performance standards, which I think might be what Heather was getting at. And that, but those are all essentially design-driven, again, design-related, I should say, considerations. Would it be possible to perhaps, instead of reinvent the wheel, why don't we borrow from that kind of an analysis that this Planning Commission is already doing now, and regard the adjustments to the square footage thresholds or maximums in the same way that you would if there's certain performance criteria, if you want to call them that, whatever they are. If the applicant comes in and can justify good reason to do this, just like an applicant in that residential context could justify the propriety of the additional density. And you all have, that's something you've already worked with and you've already approved in the past. Why not just use the same format? I agree. I don't believe it's safe for anybody involved in the process to try to interject a separate special exception kind of an exercise as part of what is essentially a design-driven development approval process. You may already have your solution in a residential context if you just wanted to borrow that and use it as this. And you may not want to limit it to merely square footage maximums for a particular commercial user. You may want to look at it in any number of terms. We talked about parking. There's other criteria or other facets of it. You may already have some of the tools in your toolbox if you just sort of tailor it to this.
Heather, what do you think?
I think I am willing to do anything that the Planning Commission wants to explore. I believe that there is definitely merit and advantages of keeping the process in the Planning Commission.
That dumping it off the Board of Appeals is not.
I lived through the development of the Walmart, and it, you know, as Dr. O'Brien alluded to, it was a traumatic thing for Mount Airy at the time, and then that's how we got these regulations. So
that was one issue.
But as residents of this community, I mean, I guess, you know, you need to drill down to, you know, your visioning of this, you know, what the end result would be. It can be achieved several different ways. I need some direction as to...
I'm sorry, what's the smell of the candy guy?
I don't think we're going to do it.
Food. They're feeding us.
Okay.
Sorry.
They're, you know...
Can we, I mean, I like the suggestion about having some sort of a toolbox with...
Performance standards?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
I mean, I don't think, I we all agree, we shouldn't be dumping to the Board of Appeals. We all agree on that one. Okay.
Yeah.
We all also
That's
agree...
That's an important distinction. Right. That, okay. That gets us.
Gets us someplace. Okay, we all do like the idea of... I guess I'm off of the 15,000 square foot, okay? We all kind of agree on that one.
Victory, okay, see?
But how we do this, and I do kind of agree, the market is the market. I just don't want to, and I live on Lookout Avenue, so Beck property is right next to me, and Center Street is right next to me. So I do have a very, very vested interest, too, on what I'm going to look at behind my pine trees. So, and it's downhill for me, thank goodness. But so how can we take, again, have something where the market can drive everything, but that we get what we want?
Just general poll, I mean, is there a consensus that the Planning Commission would like to develop a process that stays within the Planning Commission to consider those uses above 65,000?
Absolutely.
Yes. Absolutely.
Yeah. All right. So, you know what, allow me to research other codes for that, because up to this point, this is the first we've actually had meaningful discussion with respect to this code provision. So not only are we going just to 65,000, we are talking about going beyond. So allow me to react to that and see what's out there, see what our current code may provide, and see what I can bring back for consideration.
All right, well, if this was Montgomery County, wouldn't they also, I mean, I used to live right next to Rio, so I know.
They do not have any restrictions.
Yeah, they don't have
limits.
Yeah, I don't
If we're talking about the tiers, but I think the language that Dave was just referencing, and I think it's easily found. I think we can all do a little bit of research. I think we're all gonna look at a lot of these things and see, hey, here's one example, maybe this will work, and then we can tinker with it, or you guys can tinker with it how you want. But I think the language exists in many different places to give you quality design.
Yeah, I don't want to spend Heather's time or her life reinventing the wheel.
Right, I think it's out there, and I think we'll all help.
Okay, that would be great. Moving forward, 1, 2, 3.
Heather? Page 9.
What page are we on?
And Bill, thank you very much for bringing that up and initiating that. In addition to, well, we expected it from the CAS runners.
Yeah. No surprise there. No.
What?
Okay, so are we at a point where who's brain dead and who wants to stop? Or
I think
can we look forward to see what else we have to discuss?
Oh, sure.
Okay.
Most of my comments were related to that exact issue.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Thanks for all your comments. They're very much appreciated and your time.
Thank you.
Come join us again.
Okay. Hotels, and this young lady also talked about hotels as a special exception, but that's all.
You know, I'd be happy to. I think it's an important piece that needs to be included in this. Absolutely.
Yeah. I think that came up initially when we were, and I think the only reason that, I can't remember why we didn't include it, but I can tell you when I was looking through this earlier today in preparation for this very important meeting, when I first saw Motel, which I think was in Melissa's, I thought that could be good as long as it doesn't get into that up to 65,000 square foot range. And I think that's what we had talked about. In fact, I thought hotels were in here, like small sort of.
We talked about hotels with the OPE.
We talked about boutique sort of smaller hotels that fit in with.
But now with the way that we're doing this, then, you know.
So we
started our journey much different.
Yeah.
Chuck?
Carroll Creek, I was also involved with that. Do you really want to specify, and I get, do you want to specify each individual use here? They're very specific.
Yeah, that's actually a good point.
For example, real estate office, I looked here, it's not listed. First of all, if you're going to do permitted uses, you need to be, I would recommend being more general. If you're concerned about particular uses, spell out what you don't want and don't go down the road of trying to list every use, because I guarantee you'll miss one. Or there'll be a new use that's just going to pop up tomorrow that you're going to want to be there, and you're going to have to go through an amendment process. I think you want to rethink the specificity that you're going to put along your list here. It will do you a lot of grief later on if you do this.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So if there was, in the minutes of conversations, things that you can remember that were specific that you didn't want, those are the things that he's talking about.
So making one just general and coming back
tattoo parlors used to be verboten. They're now the bomb.
Oh, yeah.
And the places are there. So it is really difficult. You know, if you want retail, or office, and if you don't want, and again, you know, wineries start to come in, and all, you can't imagine. So you really want to think about what you don't want. And I can think of a few of the things off the top of my head that I'm sure you can listen to.
Right.
Those are things you probably want to just say, these are, you don't want, the smelting operations or some, noxious odors. And again, you may want to go into the performance standards of what kind of
uses that generate, you know, loud noises or those things so that you can then start to draw those things out from a, rather than individual uses, because I think you'll...
One of the first drafts didn't specifically enumerate it, but when we got to talking, we were really detailing our how we wanted this to function. We wanted to be walking on a nice autumn day, and we wanted to go into the flower store and the butcher shop, and we created a journey. So,
it was a beautiful journey. Did they have this list? Only these?
only those. So, and in one of my drafts.
I would recommend if you can't specify, allow for a mix of uses. Again, it depends. I mean, I've seen ones that they really specify. We want a true mix. We want it to be a certain percentages, or we want to try to achieve a range. And I think our mixed use requires you from, like, you have to have a minimum 15 non-residential or minimum 15% commercial. And in between the two, we don't care. But you have to be, you don't want the vacant buildings. You want them to be able to reoccupy these things. But you want to deal with the problems that you have. And I'm not sure I can, I'm not qualified to tell you what these problem areas are. You know that, you've seen them coming before mm-hmm. you.
Yeah. Okay, I mean, head's nodding. Do you like that? His suggestions make me up.
So we're just going to come up with larger categories of
things that we don't want as opposed to the things that we are going to allow.
I will give you, Carroll Creek has, and I can get you their ordinance online, they specify what they permit. And they list also more specifically what they don't permit.
Right.
And those are the kinds of, you may want to go to certain areas and say, what's that zoning ordinance? And I can tell you Carroll Creek has one like that.
A little bit more
confused. Yeah, and they have a Carroll Creek overlay that's district awesome. That specifies what specific uses are not permitted in those areas.
So you're permitting general
right.
categories and excluding specific uses. Yeah.
Right,
yeah.
Right.
Yeah, like, yeah.
I like that. Too bad we didn't hear that before the OP. Really. Mm-hmm. Too bad we didn't hear that before we...
Well, it was important for us to identify all 300 types of magic.
Right.
That is an exercise I will never.
That was such a fun exercise.
I think that worked,
though. This goes back to your conversation about the industrial. We're finding out from an economic development perspective, these neighbors and things like this that want to come into your communities, and they're artsy type of things, but they're also industrial operations when they want to do certain artsy type of fencing or whatever. Well, they make fences. That's an industrial use, but it's artsy looking. Well, would you not allow that? And some people say, well, we want that. And, well, you're using
then they get it, and it's grinders and sanders and saws.
I'm just saying there's performance standards right. on right. sign on noise and those types of things that or you make it a conditional use.
Right.
You make certain ones that are in that area allowable, but they do have to go to a special exception process because when they do have this types of use. So again, those are things that you may want to think about.
Well, we do have conditions to use on page 12 and 17 that, you know, states processes and equipment employed and goods processed shall be limited to those which are not objectionable or reasonable by reason of odor, dust, smoke, cinders, right. gas, fume. We might look like the right word, yeah. So we have covered that. So the, Phil, we're not... Basically, all of the remainder of your comments were the 65,000. Okay, I want to make sure that I'm not skipping anything.
No, you're right. It's worth the 65,000.
And Melissa's stuff with that. So, hotels.
The last comment is the height. Well, the hotels,
we're taking care of the hotels.
The height. Yeah. So we propose 40 feet in height, and...
Now, where is that?
I would say, based on all the stuff that you guys have talked about tonight,
12.
You're really keeping it quite wide open. Give yourself the opportunity that there is no height limit. It's designed, well, no, I shouldn't say that, because I mean,
we're not having skies, right?
But for, why put it at a point that's right at where things are going to probably be? Like, these products, if we're able to build, if the market bears, you know, two or three stories over first floor retail, they probably, you know, it might be 15 feet on the first floor retail, okay, 12 feet for the next two.
Okay, that's really good.
Those things are really close. Maybe the number gets a little higher, and then you say, all right, it's 50 feet, but anything over 50 feet goes under that same standard that we had talked about for over 65,000 square feet.
But Mr. Oscar always pointed out, we don't have a bucket truck. Remember that? We don't have that, we, that for the fire department.
Well, that's okay. Then it, we go. Then it wouldn't meet the APFO, so then they couldn't get the approval. I mean, you still have to. You still have to meet that standard.
I mean, buy the truck.
Yeah, and maybe somebody will buy the truck. And there you go.
Well, and also
donate the truck.
Craig has to drive it.
Craig will drive it. There's another thing when you
don't cash that check for a while.
Some of these are just facades. You know, that's not a two-story, for example, that Barnes & Noble.
Yeah,
it just that's not like a two-story. So right, there may be some design elements that aren't actually occupied but are above the 40 feet right, because of the design. Because of the way they're designed. Also with topography, this is one thing we've run into Montgomery County many times. Where do you measure from? Because there's going to be some topography mm-hmm. that's like this. Mm-hmm. And if it's a two-sided store, for example, where are you measuring? If there's a store on the bottom and then there's a store on the top, and they may be two separate stores, mm-hmm. where are you measuring from? So some of the height may be that, okay, we're going to give you up to this amount, but above that, I think the design standards then kick in. Okay, why are we giving you this? Because it works for this product or that product. Like that.
I kind of like that because I know now in my mind that I would envision something different on the left as you're going north, the right side of 27, different. I would envision something different if it was coming in here towards Center Street.
Sure.
The height would be lower coming into town here, you know, to help with the topography, but also to be in line with the town and what the town has as you're coming in downtown. But if you're on the other side, and you might need a 3.5 or 4 feet, then that doesn't really...
Things will dip, yeah. Front to back, side to side,
yeah.
To, you know, top yeah. of the hill, bottom of the hill, and the type of product that you're talking about, they're all going to have different things. I mean, sometimes you can use a building as a retaining wall, so it's built into the
yeah.
back, and it's only got one side, but there's a yeah. top side that comes out the other. So giving yourselves the design flexibility, very much like all of the other provisions that we've been talking about, I think is really
yeah.
important than giving a specific number that says you can't do anything about that.
We're talking about a lot of different products that are vertically related. We're talking about multifamily units. Those are 4 or 5 splits. They could be 4 stories. They could be 5 stories. We're talking about residential or ground floor or retail. Just the ground floor stuff, like you put 15-foot ceilings, 20-foot ceilings,
right.
then go above it. If you're talking about things that are very vertical, parking garages, all these things, you don't want to put that height cap and then keep running into it over and over and over on different uses. You want to just judge the design overall. You're going to have a higher point that, like you said, spreads out to the lower point and then get it back into the town. But the height limit is definitely, as it's written now, is an issue.
Any thoughts? I think at this point,
why you quit? One, I think you always need to establish a minimum standard for expectation. But as we talked before, your plan development provisions, mm-hmm. you allow for modifications for that as part of the design, allow for that for them to come in with that. I think it's achievable through that process.
I think, Heather, is it possible for those, you know, situations? Now that we're going to be looking at it, I would ask if you know of any other ordinances that maybe pertain to that when it comes to the height. Maybe you could pass that along to Heather. Because I think now that we're sort of expanding our horizons, that maybe we'll just expand our horizons when it comes to what should be here from other mm-hmm. other areas. And so rather than belabor it tonight, because
yeah.
it's just too late, maybe we'll just revisit that.
Okay.
Sorry, Heather, we're fading fast.
It's okay. I just enjoy spending time.
I do want to say one thing, and I thank everybody that was here for their input. It's very important to us. And I also want to thank the Cass brothers because, you're very flexible and willing, and you have excellent suggestions, and coming in makes it a lot easier to develop what we're going through than to have any kind of animosity. And I really appreciate the fact that you really have done a lot in helping to bring this to fruition. I appreciate that.
Okay, so at that point, we're going to stop and just jump over to a very quick update to the 27 quarter status update, which is probably they're working on it.
Actually, staff met with the consultant last week, and they have some. They're working on their recommendations as a result of their studies. And the first quarter, we're planning for a stakeholders meeting. First quarter, 2017. Planning on a stakeholders meeting and then presentation to planning commission and town council. So we are nearing wrapping it up in the first quarter of 2017.
Great. How about
did you have anything else to add, Barney?
Nope.
Okay.
Nope,
I wanted to make sure.
Okay, side ordinance work session. We had a fantastic session with town council. It's one of those days I never want to forget. So
And I do apologize. I intended to have a bullet point of what was discussed, but I haven't been able to complete that for you. So it is on my task list for this week. So I'll send that out to everybody. But we do need some additional discussions.
Yes, we do.
Yeah, we do.
Quite a bit.
It needs to be done before May.
Okay. Heather, do you want anything else about?
The edge.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Now.
But this way, the work session started at 7 and ended at 9:25.
Okay. We got a lot done. We did.
Okay, council liaison report, Bob?
I have nothing simply because this is my second, maybe the only other one I've been to is a sign ordinance. I've done no EDC meetings for 2 months and no planning commission meetings for 2 months.
Well, welcome back.
Glad to have you back.
Okay, so next planning commission meeting, we have voted to have it on November 21st. I don't know if, so I know there was a conflict between Judy and Patty, and I don't know who won.
I can do either one.
Oh, okay.
So
it was better than that.
I could too.
Patty preferred the 21st.
Okay. Yeah, I prefer
the 21st. If you need kitchen help, I'll come help you in the kitchen.
Okay. Okay. Yeah. Okay, after you're done with her, could you come up?
Former chef, no problem.
21st, right?
Yeah, 21st. But I could go either way. So.
And for you, clients, Patty. We have some
this is for you.
Applicants coming from like way out of town.
Yeah,
you have to fly in, so it's actually a little bit, Michigan and Texas.
Yep.
So.
Okay. So upcoming downtown master plan, we're just working on it. Let's just say that, unless you want to add anything. Okay, zoning administrator reports here. Okay, so all those in favor of adjourning the meeting, say aye.
Aye. So are you adjourning? You mentioned the MPCA meeting. I don't know if you signed up for our MPCA. You all do very great in terms of your planning commission role here, but there is a planning commissioner training on Thursday, 1 o'clock, at 12:30.
Yep.
I hope you're all going to be there. And we have completed the working in Frederick section to be right at start at 3 o'clock. So
right.
We've got everything combined together. So I hope you look forward to seeing you there.
And this is the same training software,
yes.
MML and
it's the same training. So if you've been there before and you've got that,
okay, so all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Okay, meeting adjourns at 10:07.